Hello and welcome to episode 215 of the Crate and Crowbar. It is the 15th of November 2017. My name is Chris Thurston, and tonight I'm joined by Tom Francis.
Hello.
And Tom Senior.
Hello.
Dual glass in Tom Senior.
Absolutely.
Wine to his right, beer to his left.
That's how I do.
Which way will he go?
Wine first, then beer. And then, I don't know what the rhyme is.
No. We discussed this earlier. We've completely forgotten what that mnemonic is.
Feeling mortal fear.
I feel that every moment of the day.
Yes. Wine, then beer.
It's true, but doesn't entirely cover the situation.
A recipe for terror. So, by the time you're listening to this, Star Wars Battlefront II will be out, which seems to be the nexus of the week's gaming ire.
Misery.
Yes. As we start off the pod with our traditional ire section.
It's the misery nexus of the week is,
yes. Yeah. To the extent that I was actually genuinely a little bit, appalled, I think. Is that the word? Yeah, I think it's probably the word. To click onto the BBC World News homepage, which I do from time to time to find out what's happening in the world, to see, two stories about the negative player response to Battlefront II's microtransaction systems, neatly juxtaposed with the rest of the world's news, which included the shooting of a North Korean defector, the coup in Zimbabwe, and something else, the Iraq-Iran earthquake disaster, which I appreciate that channel has a tech column, but it really put things in perspective in terms of...
yeah. Sure
news, you know? Needless to say, that is the thing, what is happening right now in the games business. And yeah, it's a weird one. So on top of this, the game's actually out. Well, yesterday, if you're listening to this on Saturday when this pod is coming out, the game came out yesterday, but it came out on the Origin early access thing, not early access. What do they call that?
EA access.
EA access. So early access.
Yep. electronic access.
Yeah. And upon doing so, or like the first X number of hours came out, as happened with Mass Effect Andromeda. And like Mass Effect Andromeda, that has done nothing but tremendous damage to the game's reputation. So at the top of this, you kind of have to wonder how long that's going to keep happening. You know?
Well, they have course corrected, haven't they? And I suppose there's virtue in doing that before the main launch rather than after the main launch.
Mm.
If there was still something to discover about the public's reaction to this, because didn't they already do a beta?
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was really popular then.
Yeah.
But I guess the progression system must be either different or they expect it to be different in this version, because there's been huge uproar over the amount of time or money it takes to... E.g. unlock a hero.
Yeah. I think...
someone said it takes 40 hours to unlock Darth Vader or Luke Skywalker, based on sort of some tests they did with timing themselves and how often they earn credits. And they did specify that this excluded things, like there were challenges to complete and stuff, and the first time you complete those, you get a chunk of credits, and he was excluding that. But then, yeah, that caused enough of a backlash that the... an EA representative's reply to a comment on this on Reddit is the most downvoted comment in Reddit history by a factor of about 10. It's about 10 times as many downvotes as anything has ever received in the history of Reddit.
Jesus Christ.
And he's like, the reply is like, oh, well, we wanted to have a rich, rewarding progression system. And of course, we're listening to you and we'll change this in response to, he didn't say we'll change it in response to comments, but we're listening and we'll adapt to feedback we receive. So it was basically a kind of open-ended thing of like, we might change this, but it was still like, fuck you to hell.
People just wanted a man to kick, I think.
Yeah.
It's interesting. So I think to offer some context, people don't know the exact details. I think when that beta test happened, people realized that there were quite, game power related things hidden away in loot chests. So the game has a system, as the first one did, called Star Cards, where your kind of special abilities are like cards you have as a deck. So things that would be on a cooldown, normal shooter cooldown abilities are things you swap in and out. In the first game, you unlocked them, but it was really no different to unlocking new loadouts or something in any other shooter of the last decade. In this one, you unlock like upgraded versions of them as well, which are just like flat out better. It's just like this one does 35% more damage than the previous one. And that's based on random chance through a loot box. That was the thing people were upset about first time around. Then but I think it was the early access version of the game that demonstrated not just that, but also the scale of the grind involved in unlocking hashtag content. And that has, I think, led to this like extraordinary backlash. Like, you know, seeing the little screenshot of the game thumbnailed among actual world crises was sort of funny and disturbing and kind of, you know, one of those 2017 things. But this seems to have gone like wildly deep in terms of how many people are pissed off at it to the extent of it propelling the most downvoted comment in Reddit history.
Yeah. I'd be really interested to know what sales look like. I bet they're still really good.
Yeah. I mean, so I think about this a bunch because Blizzard put out a trailer for StarCraft II going free to play today that I saw it because Marsh linked to it and described it as, you know, EA, so Blizzard just delivering a sort of sprightly pop to EA's nuts, basically. EA's collect, you know, just right in the kneecaps, which is where EA's nuts are. I wanted to make that less implicitly masculine, but it just ended up being confusing. Which is where like a father berates his son in a kind of kind way for assuming that StarCraft is a game where it's funny, but you know, is a game where you can buy an advantage. Like, no, we don't do that in my house. This is StarCraft. We do things like we used to, which is fine for Blizzard to do. Of course they can do that as long as they don't mention Hearthstone in the same sentence, basically. It's clear that like, given that this comes at the head of, it feels like every podcast we've done in the last month has opened with some discussion of some like loot crate controversy or something like that. It feels like this must come to a head somewhere where publishers maybe now get scared of it, but it doesn't mean you won't see it immediately, but it means that maybe you stop seeing it next year as publishers rush to strip it out in favor of something else, because this is the kind of press you get, or maybe it won't matter at all.
I suspect the latter. I think, they've been in games for so long. I mean, we've said this before, like the variations on this system have existed in many, many games. In fact, even if it's not explicitly a loot box, for example, World of Warcraft's early progression systems were far, far more egregious than like 40 hours to unlock Darth Vader if you actually wanted to progress. Like progression system balance has been a perennial problem for lots of games that have tried to become long form games. And that seems to be what people are annoyed at in this precise moment about Battlefront 2. It's the amount is that you've paid $60 for a game and you expect to be able to play Darth Vader straight away, but actually there's loads and loads of, you know, effort that needs to go into getting it. But that's loads of games do that with their systems.
I think the impression I got was that the time it took to unlock these things was being reacted to because it was seen as and this is why you have to pay for it. Like they make the free progression so arduous that they push you towards spending I haven't checked this figure, but somebody said it was $2,100 to unlock everything.
there's some really bad maths going into those figures that people are doing on websites and on Reddit and stuff. Like, so for example, I believe as far as I'm aware, you can't actually just buy characters. You can buy boxes which have a chance of giving you credits, and credits are what you use to buy characters, and you earn credits by completing matches and stuff. But it's a little bit less straightforward than you could just simply buy your way past it in the way that, you know, a lot of internet comment threads are trying to make out that is the case. If you were desperate to get Vader and you were happy to play the RNG loot box game to get credits out of loot boxes, then of course you could potentially put, you know, an infinite amount of money into that system because it's an RNG system. But sensibly, no one would do that. I mean, not even like a Rich McCormick, bless him, who, you know, fell down the...
our friend the whale.
Rich absolutely loved, you know, Ultimate... what's the ultimate FIFA system? Ultimate,
Ultimate Team.
Ultimate Team.
Mass Effect 3 loot boxes as well.
Yeah. So Rich has like a soft spot for that stuff. But I think like with those examples, you can see yourself materially unlocking the characters straight away with any given box. I don't think that's the case with this. I think like you can't just buy a box and then Darth Vader pops out. It's not quite like that. It's like, I think it's a structural progression system problem.
So the thing EA said is that they're going to redress the tuning and they're going to change some things about like they're going to make it so that progression with a specific character unlocks things for that character. Because I think that was one of the issues people had, was that your progress is completely general. Whereas, you know, I agree with you that these aren't unprecedented systems, but I think if you get the tuning sufficiently wrong, they become almost like unprecedentedly bad.
Right.
Like, it's almost like this entire thing is about like a pain tolerance level. And so if the game is like, you know, so the games that I love, like Titanfall has, you know, like tons of unlocks. And I know that, Discord regular / walking CNC wiki man Kane, hated the game because he just really doesn't gel with unlock systems. And Titanfall 2 has quite a lot of like, it gives you like, another EA game, as it happens, it gives you like sort of like a pyramid of unlock things. So you have like your base level, which is like your account wide thing that goes up a little bit every game. And then you get the, you know, particular kind of character you were playing, particular kind of Titan you were using. And then you have the particular guns you were using, particular loadout you're using within that thing.
Yeah.
And I really liked that system actually, because it was scaled so that you finish a match and everything goes up one, but it's quite specific, but it's also branching out. So you feel like you've gotten cool new skins for the things that you like using, and you've also unlocked something in a different direction that might pull you somewhere else in the system. So I personally think these systems can create a kind of fun progression set. But crucially, actually, in that game, in Titanfall 2, the unlocks aren't random. You know, everything progresses down a tree, essentially, based on where you're investing your time. And I think there's a big difference in feel between that and Battlefront's kind of strictly, at the moment, strictly random system, where you're just getting generic points to invest anywhere in this big web of nodes that you'll probably never see the end of. And when the option to try and buy your way out of it, and inevitably when the option comes along, when there's, you know, season passes and DLC, when your characters plop in, I can see it getting oppressive. I mean, and this is also interesting because they've committed to things like maps being free for Battlefront, maps and modes, so they avoid splitting the community. So they've learned that lesson, but it feels like they've dialed like the shitty end of monetization up to 11 in order to make up for that potential shortfall.
I think a lot of it is just terribly communicated as well. Like, yeah. The UI is abysmal for all of that stuff. Like, it's like a catacomb you go into, perhaps by design or perhaps just because it's poorly designed. And I think that, like, Jeff Fazek made a very good comment on Twitter about this, where he said that, see, he screenshotted like the comments about, you know, I've paid $60 out and I have to grind to get Vader. And, Chet said that, like, once upon a time, this would look like player entitlement, but the player conversation with EA is so broken at this point that it's easy to see the player side far more easily. It's not just about this one game. It's about EA's, reputation for doing this sort of thing across their entire, their entire, you know, the library.
Yeah, I feel like this is an opportunity for them to come out, because people, when I say Battlefront 1, I mean the previous one in the EA iterations of the Battlefront games, right? When that came out, people were sort of upset that it felt like quite a slight offering, including me, actually. There's that, you know, where's the single player campaign? Where's all of this stuff? And they have addressed that in terms of it's a much bigger game. It covers all three eras of Star Wars. It has the single player campaign, you know, all this stuff. And so for them to then take stuff that was just sort of available by default in the first game, like heroes, and then lock them away, whether that system is well balanced or not, again, feels like this. It feels like every time EA have an opportunity to repair the damage to their reputation, they fuck up somewhere else. You know what I mean? Like, it feels like they could make it's fucking Star Wars. You're gonna make a ton of money from it regardless. And they probably are gonna make a ton of money from it regardless. But it does feel like you're right. Not just the communication, but the sort of like min-maxing of revenue opportunities within the game is so transparent that it just generates a bad feeling. Like, I feel weird about it because I actually would really like to play it.
Yeah.
Like, you know,
you feel like you can't trust it though. That's the thing, I think. Like, it feels as though if, you're paying for a product that is going to try and suck you into different, you know, ways of paying again. And that's the poisonous feeling then.
Yeah.
And the amount of credits you need to unlock those heroes, they reduced it by 75%, which that also breaks your trust in the system, either the system before or the system now, or just their interest in making a system that's balanced. It's just, if you can change something by a factor of that, then it was either drastically wrong before, or maybe it's drastically wrong now, or maybe the whole thing is just a mess.
What it suggests is that their value criteria is not what's right for the player's ideal experience, it's what can we get away with.
Yeah.
basically. And then it's like, oh, sorry, overtune this one. That, you know.
If it had only been the second most downvoted comment in Reddit history, they would have reduced it by 25%.
Yeah, it's funny because, you know, this is ultimately a multiplayer game I'm not very interested in, bolted to a single-player Star Wars shooter by the guy who wrote Spec Ops The Line and my friend Mitch.
Mm.
So that's the thing that in any other circumstance I would be kind of rushing to get. And I still might just lump the £50 for the eight-hour single-player campaign.
Right. Yeah.
Because I don't know how else I'm going to get to play it, you know? Like, I want it uncoupled from all of that shit, but... And I know that I have a, you know, I know that Star Wars is an easy in for me. Like, I will probably, you know, invest a bit in something with that title. I do wonder what Lucasfilm will make of this situation, because that is a company that has taken its goodwill building exercises pretty seriously in the last couple of years. Like, obviously, you know, Star Wars is a hyper commercial entity. You know, both Lucasfilm and Disney and, you know, everyone involved. This is not, you know, art for art's sake. It is a business, but they have, you know, taken a lot of strain to kind of always be creating the right kind of experience for fans, that kind of thing. Basically that I've seen that a few different contexts, including Star Wars Celebration. And in terms of like how people communicate, like obviously there's some controversy about the secrecy that all Star Wars things are held in and the kind of the sometimes kind of, the ways in which directors drop in and out of those projects and stuff like that. And it's centrally managed nature. But a lot of that feels like it's genuinely out of a corporate, but I think earnest desire to kind of make something that's genuinely a positive experience for the vast majority of people who encounter it. So they've made this kind of redoubled effort to support the fact that Star Wars has a new young female audience because of the characters of the latest films, and to kind of back that up with new waves of toys and games and cartoons and things that are not created to exclusively cater to that audience, but don't ignore that audience in the way that, you know, things like Star Wars traditionally have. So there's all this effort to make sure that, like, it's the most accessible entertainment thing in the world, and you're guaranteed a good experience if you buy into it, and you can trust your kids with it, and all of this stuff that I think is probably possibly dystopian in the sense that they want it to be a completely frictionless water slide that you go down to and then you have no money left. But it's better than we are going to trick people into liking this and just rob them for everything they're worth, right? There's some element of like, we're going to use our resources to try and make something that's better than it was. And so I wonder if I don't think that these business models in themselves would be off-putting, but I wonder if this degree of backlash, like if sort of front page, you know, if you Google like Andrew House or something today, that this story is everywhere, right? This story is the only story about EA at the moment. It's basically the only story about Star Wars at the moment. Like, you know, it's, you wonder at what point would Lucasfilm step in and say, please make something that doesn't generate this kind of attention, please. Yeah. Like, we don't want the word Star Wars and giant ripoff.
Please don't have a negative story about Star Wars on the front page of a world news site.
Exactly. All of them as well, like at the same time.
Yeah, I think backlashes have short-term effect, but what ends up happening is the company is very good at just reframing the same thing in a different way.
Mm.
So look at Always Online DRM. Remember that fury, like in 2012, 2013, whenever that was? Ubisoft with their just insanely draconian, just, you know, stops you playing the game if you get logged off in Assassin's Creed 2, as it used to be. Almost all games have a form of always online DRM now. They've just streamlined it and reframed it and done it in the background, and people accept it now. And I think similar things will happen with this.
It did actually cause a fuss with Hitman, the episodic ones. That has a pretty, I think it's a mixed reviews on Steam or something around that region. And a lot of the negatives are about the fact that it has to be always online, even though it's an entirely single player game. That game actually does let you play offline a bit, but it's just what it locks off is so offensive. It's just like, it's not only that you don't get the stuff you've unlocked, because, you know, you unlock weapons and stuff by doing challenges and that's all authenticated on their server, but you can't even, like, it won't even tell you how you did on the level. It will just hide stats from you and you can't complete challenges. You can't even see what challenges are. So it just like clamps down on a whole chunk of the game that doesn't feel like there's any reason to.
Mm. Right. I think I see where you're coming from, Tom. I think, however, the scale of the backlash gets bigger every time, and it attracts more and more attention.
Mm.
And always on DRM is a sort of hard problem to frame to somebody who, for example, doesn't really know how games work. Darth Vader costs you £2,000.
Right.
Is not.
That's a bad headline, isn't it?
Even though that's not true in any practical sense.
True. Yep.
This feels like enough of a, because, you know, even the, what was the other game that had this issue recently? Not Call of Duty. Call of Duty was the exploding loot crates to Normandy Beach.
Need for Speed had some.
Need for Speed. There was another one recently that maybe it was Battlefront. Oh, and Battlefront. I don't understand how time works.
I think it was the beta.
Yeah. You know, when this thing happened with this game earlier, but it feels like if anything was going to sort of ensure that the loot box conversation really doesn't go away, it might be a high profile Star Wars related PR crisis.
Yeah, that's true.
Right. If anything was going to do it. And basically, if it survives this without some changes or some sort of, then it is probably never going to go away. Right. And that's maybe a good reason not to invest in it, no matter how much I want to play the single player, basically. Not that my boycott's going to mean anything, because it's like boycotting air.
It will kill you.
Yeah. Yes. No.
I will say that actually, I really enjoyed the loot box system in Mass Effect 3.
Yeah.
Mass Effect 2, was it in there as well?
No, just 3.
Just 3. That felt like a really fun progression system to me. And I enjoyed just randomly getting classes and not knowing quite what I was going to get. Those actually, it's the point where the RNG didn't feel exploitative. It felt exciting. And I could pay money, but I never did and never felt the need to. You could play a few rounds of a game that I was enjoying anyway to unlock stuff, and that felt like a sweet spot for this stuff. It's become more egregious.
I honestly think that it is just like, I wouldn't be surprised if the emergency response to this was to remove heroes from the unlock system,
because
they weren't in the first game. You unlocked stuff, but you didn't unlock heroes.
Right.
I think if they did that one thing, ironically, at that point, they'd probably get away with the fact that there's genuine player power hidden away in the loot boxes, but the fact that they had removed the slightly more egregious right. things than that.
Right.
So, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe this is some genius marketing thing. It probably isn't, because it's not gone well, if so.
Hmm.
But yeah, it's a funny old, it's funny when the product is mainstream enough like this, that this is now a conversation that's being had much more broadly than simply our traditional channels. And I say that because I know that I'm probably going to buy it.
I feel like the loot box thing and this are two slightly separate things that have become collated by the conversation around these games at the moment. So I think this hero progression thing isn't necessarily loot box controversy. I think, I think those are separate things.
Yeah. I think there's a retention mechanics, bottomless spending kind of anxiety that this taps into as
definitely,
well as loot
definitely.
Boxes. There was a really interesting Twitter thread by a man whose name I've forgotten. You might be able to help, Tom, because I think you maybe linked it, about how one of the reasons that these kind of loot box crises are interesting, particularly when it pertains to like pay to win games, is it's a rare environment where people of all wealth bands in the world are kind of participating in the same system. And therefore, one of the reasons it upsets people so much is it actually highlights real world wealth division in a way that very few things do. For the reason being that in like traditional retail, people with not a lot of money don't go to the same shops as people with a lot of money. So even though, a very, very rich person might spend £2,000 on a shirt, they don't do that in Primark, you know?
That they don't go on into a competitive environment with people who are shopping it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like they don't go to Save Square and then, you know, have a fashion off.
So yeah. So the notion that you can wander into a game and see someone walk by wearing like £3,000 worth of hats, it actually confronts you not with the broken systems of the game, although I would contest them maybe are shitty systems. Mm. It confronts you with the actual reality of the world in some ways, you know, like, you know, because, there's an interesting study into how people sort of, don't really appreciate how bad the wealth gap is in the world, right? Like 8 people, 6 of them who are American control like more than half of the world's wealth. Like, and that's, you know, and that's something that's not easy for you to think about.
Buying all the loot boxes, aren't they?
Well, yeah, but what I'm saying is like, you know, and then that, you know, trickles down from there. Well, it doesn't trickle down, that's the issue. But, like, you know, that sort of problem kind of scales down from there, like a ziggurat. And, or a scheme that looks like a pyramid, for example. And, like, even people in the middle of that still have vastly more wealth than the people below them. So a game where everyone likes a bit of whatever, COD or something. Mm. So any game that allows you to spend an extreme amount of money and demonstrate that, either in terms of power or how you look or things like that, just highlights upsetting differences in people's ability to spend on their entertainment.
I think this is the worst possible implementation of RNG systems. I think that's the other problem here. Is like, yeah, you can sort of brute force your way through it with loads and loads of money, and, you know, some people will do that. I think the great strategy is that often the people doing that can't actually afford to do it.
Yeah.
And that actually, you know, it's the RNG system itself that's offensive. It's the idea that someone next door can open a box and get an amazing thing, and you can spend loads of money and never get that thing because it's just rolling dice forever. And that's what that's the most kind of grotesque aspect of it, really, and the idea that people could be sucked into trying.
Yeah, I've seen a interesting perspective from someone who basically has a some kind of mental problem that makes her especially vulnerable to these kinds of systems where if there's a certain set of things and having all of them is in some way flagged up as completing the set, that's incredibly compulsive. And systems like this, where paying to get all the things is possible and incredibly expensive and difficult, are basically exploitative to people with that mindset.
Mm. And it's an unknown amount of money as well. Like, you don't know how much you're going to have to spend to eventually get this stuff if you're buying loot boxes.
Yeah, and it might seem like it's just around the corner, particularly right. If you have a gambling problem.
It's the bottomless thing. That's what I fundamentally mistrust about it. I'm not going to buy this game because I've no interest in engaging with that type of system, really.
Yeah. That's what bothers me about it. Like, I think, ironically, if they were selling the, like, 80 quid collector's edition, right, which came with everything, I would think about it.
Right.
And then probably late one night, I'm not telling anyone that I'd done that.
I think I never thought I'd say this, but I welcome subscription charges for games coming back. I would much rather just a flat fee and knowing what I'm getting for the money I'm spending over the course of a year, which is what I get with Destiny, for example. I know I'm going to have to spend a certain amount on DLC packs, and I'm happy to do that. And that's a subscription service, basically.
It is, yeah.
And that helps, you know, people get their money. Also maintains the integrity of the game system, so you don't have to start getting into these, like, really awful kind of, you know.
Yeah, you just feel empty when you invest in this stuff.
Yeah, it sucks.
It really sucks. It sucks. In conclusion, it's terrible. Yeah, and it's a shame. I feel for anyone who worked on that game, including, well, particularly people who worked on the single, but anyone who worked on it, actually, because I think, I'd love to play it because I think it's an interesting example. On the complete flip side, it's an interesting example of, like, getting multiple different studios to work together. I really like the idea of we live in this world where these big games have to be made by multiple studios across different territories. I like the idea of not lumbering dice with the challenge of making a single player game, letting them focus on the multiplayer games that they've always been better at making, letting a new studio but headed up with, you know, good single player cred people make the single player, and giving, like, all the vehicles to Criterion, who made Burnout, and being like, okay, Burnout people, make us X-Wings now. Like, that seems really cool to me, and I'd like to see what can emerge from, essentially, I want to see what can emerge from Mega Money. I want to see what Mega Money can do to the spaceships that I like. And with any system like this, one of the things that sucks about it is that these are big studios with lots of people in them, and lots of individually talented people, and, you know, great technical artists and programmers and so on. And when this sort of thing becomes the only story about a game, I feel this way every time this happens, but it really does devalue the work, the hard and time-consuming and life-consuming technical work of producing a game like this. Mm. And when it comes down to something like a business decision, like microtransactions, putting people off, for example, you know, there's a new Star Wars, a canon Star Wars story with a new female protagonist at the lead of it. And that should be something that is worth celebrating as this industry kind of changes and gets better at stuff. And yet that's fucking lost, right? Like, that was the screenshot on the BBC News front page, was, you know, a little picture from the reveal trailer of Jinya Nagar Ankar as the main character of the game, which you know, that could be the fluffy end of the news story, that like, hey, there's a new Star Wars story out. Maybe you don't know about it, and here it is, and here's the cool main character and all the rest of it. Nope. Like, we're lost in business land. And that's just, again, that's the reason that I wouldn't be surprised if Lucasfilm were going like, oh shit. Like, when they put out a new film, this is not the kind of conversation they want people having about Star Wars. Like, it's a giant ripoff.
It's quite close to the release of the next film as well.
Well, yeah. Yes, exactly. Like, yeah. That's not an accident either. It's like, hey, it's a month to go towards Star Wars. Yeah, until Star Wars, you're all really excited. Why not, you know, why not play with this?
Mm.
Right. Yeah, man. It's going to make so much fucking money.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Speaking of things making money, which is, speaking of businesses and games, IO, we're going to return to Hitman. We're going to talk about Hitman every single episode, Tom.
Yeah. Just briefly, there was a interview with IO on Gamma Sutra in which they discuss, you know, going independent and saying what a big deal it is. And the interesting thing in it was, one thing is that the Game of the Year edition they released recently, Square Enix get no money from that. That's 100% IO, which is cool. And also, they were just way more positive than I expected about the whole Hitman episode experiment. In that they sort of admitted they got a lot of things wrong and they had some technical issues and they changed. I don't remember what the change was, but they mentioned changing the sort of proposition before launch, like the ways you could buy it must have changed at some point, and that confused people and caused problems. But they said that the live aspect of it, like having events that happen at particular dates and the elusive targets and that kind of stuff, and having new content to kind of tell people about on a regular basis, was a huge success, and it brought in loads of new players. So I think that game has maybe done better than we thought, because it was sort of seen as a bit of a bomb, particularly because its owner sold it right after. But as far as IO are concerned, they're very pleased with that. And they kind of, the gist of this interview is that they sort of want to double down on that next time and do even more.
I'd say that, like, anecdotally on Gamer, we covered it loads and loads because there were loads of kind of grab points.
Yeah, and it's become a joke on this podcast that we just cover Hitman all the fucking time. Because
there's always like a Hitman thing happening, and we like Hitman. And
it may have been an indirect inspiration for me doing a limited time launch event at Heat Signature. Yeah, there you go. Some kind of shipment that was elusive in some way.
Elusive gun.
Yeah.
Yes, I mean, incidentally, so that interview's on gi.biz, not Gamma Sutra, just in case you're looking for it. But yeah, like, I think we've said this before, because we never stop talking about Hitman. But I'd be very happy to see that system become just a regular thing, just with, you know, improvements and to all of the things we've said every time that it comes back again. But yeah, like, you know, and also maybe this highlights the difference between publisher expectations and what can hypothetically sustain a developer. That maybe links into last week's chat about the current travails of what feel like mid-level. Either mid-level studios generally, or like the biggest indies, as companies like Telltale struggle and so on. You know, this is an example of, I guess, something that's good enough for IO, presumably not being good enough for Square.
Yeah,
and that's fine. Like, it feels like you can amicably part ways at that point.
So yeah, this is, I bet there are loads of cases like this where the game is making the kind of money the developer would be delighted with and could easily keep going under, but the publisher or the parent company who owns them is only interested in putting all of their weight behind some real cash cows, behind some things that make infinite money.
They're interested in the ceiling, the kind of profit ceiling on the thing, and if it's not as high as they thought it would be, then they could put that money elsewhere and actually get that.
Yeah, exactly.
I feel that way now. It feels like over the last month, actually, sort of this feeling's evolved, but like, I do feel that we have to start thinking of the big publishers, by which I mean EA, Activision, Ubisoft, as being in almost like a tier of their own now. Not that we need like new words. Like, it's not like there's an extra A. It's not like four A's.
Don't go to four A's. It can't be done.
It's just like, it's just screaming after a certain point.
Appropriately.
It's not that. It's that, like, they are at a level where it's not simply about creating big budget games that sell well. It's about creating hyper efficient service game engines that sort of succeed from a business point of view on every tier at once. Like, they're a premium product that also can make a bottomless amount of money after the fact.
Yeah. So a service game is ongoing. There are loads of different revenue points that, you know, revenue streams within that product. Like, I mean, Destiny's the a great example. I'm not sure that their microtransaction stuff is that compelling, but, you know, as a service game that's going to keep on making money and making money, then that's a great example for Activision.
Although it'd be interesting to see if that game has made enough money. Yeah. I don't know if it's been a big deal.
About what their expectations are, isn't it? Yes. I don't know what their shareholders would want.
I feel like, yeah, I feel like the safest job at EA is probably like the person who makes furniture for The Sims, honestly. I think The Sims is a really interesting example of like probably, you know, it keeps getting big expansions. It could quietly ticks around. The game's press doesn't cover it that much that often, but you know, that's got to make a shitload of money.
Yeah.
Basically constantly because there's always a new thing coming out. Mm. There's always more money to spend. It's really fucking expensive to get everything that exists for The Sims 4.
It always has been though. Like The Sims has always been that.
Yeah, exactly. Cause it's the only thing people play, right? Yeah, like, you know, between EA and Activision, they're basically dividing the market on the only games people play, right? Like COD, FIFA, you know, something out for The Sims.
And actually a lot of their most successful stuff is actually outside of our world, really. Like, it is your FIFAs and your Sims are being played, and football managers and things like that are being played by people who are into those things, not into games as a kind of hobby.
Actually, in that context, I wonder if I would still include Ubisoft in that triumvirate, because obviously they're a big company and they make a bunch of money, but actually their behavior doesn't quite fit that pattern.
No.
Because obviously something like Assassin's Creed's a big release, but I don't think Origins isn't like laden with microtransaction hooks, is it? Or
no, you can buy like resource packs and legendary weapons and stuff, but it's just never even been a factor for me. Although I did have one thought while I was playing that struck me as kind of hilariously potentially evil, which is that you need resources to upgrade your like the damage that your hidden blade does and the damage that your melee weapons do, and it's a big deal because it's universal to your character. So even if you upgrade melee damage, it's not just upgrading that weapon, it's upgrading all melee weapons you ever use forever. And to do that, you need to get some resources from like raiding convoys and stealing their metal or whatever. But anything that's like leather, you get it from killing an animal. And for whatever reason, something in my brain is broken and I no longer have any trouble with killing animals in games. Like, well, actually, no, that's not true, because I remember we talked about Dishonored recently and I avoided killing all the dogs. There's, in some cases, it bothers me, and in some cases, it doesn't.
Is that thing
Assassin's
dogs?
Creed? I think it's like, I don't know what it is. It's just they become very much resource nodes to me in Assassin's Creed, and I just harvest them in incredibly efficient ways, and it's very satisfying. I don't think of them as animals at all. But
I'm pretty sure that's how real animal welfare abuses begin.
So you need a lot of it. You need to like kill, you know, I just discovered, in a level 29 side quest that crocodiles are incredibly sacred to ancient Egyptians, and to the point where when Bayek discovers that some smugglers have, some people have set up like a secret shop where they are killing crocodiles to make like bags from it, he's livid and literally says they deserve to die, and then your next mission hunt them down and kill them. And I am wearing 42 crocodiles on my wrist alone. I have murdered scores of crocodiles. They never told me they were sacred. I would have avoided them.
Is it the city of Crocodilopolis?
Yeah.
Which I just love that was actually a historical thing that, you know, they named
Crocodile Town.
Crocodilopolis. crocodiles.
It's weird how Ubisoft games especially distort that stuff.
Like, so the evil thing that I was going to say was I was reflecting on the fact that I don't seem to have a problem with killing like deer to get leather or whatever. And then I'd also noticed that it's possible to buy resource packs with real money, and hadn't been tempted because I'm like, I quite enjoy the game of getting this. And there is, God, if you really have a problem with like killing cute, innocent animals, you would have to pay real money to avoid it, basically. That's the only way you do it, is just pay money to not have to kill the animals.
The vegan buyout.
Yeah, exactly.
You buy Soylent crocodile skin.
Yeah. But nonetheless, like, I think it's interesting because I would almost now think of Ubisoft as being like a big Bethesda. This game is all weird. So what I mean is that like, so Bethesda are interesting, I think, because they make, you know, they've got a track record now of years upon years of, obviously they've experimented with things like paid mods that have been unpopular.
That's one of the top 10 most downvoted comments on Reddit.
But
Gabe Newell responding to that.
But predominantly they make single player, chunky single player campaigns.
Yeah, it's pretty old school actually.
And old school shooters like Wolfenstein, Prey, Quake, New Quake is a free to play thing, Doom, I mean. Dishonored, that sort of thing. And then Ubisoft are kind of interesting because they do make these massive open world games and stuff like that with microtransaction hooks, but they also made things like Mario Rabbids, which I think, you know, obviously that's going to sell well and it has done extremely well critically, but they got quite a good hit rate. So I'm sort of now wondering where you kind of, I think their place in the sort of triumvirate of shite business mechanics was based on maybe the stuff like the DRM of a couple of years ago when they were the company generating those kind of consumer rights stories. And now they've kind of slipped in the good way into the sort of just a big game publisher kind of slot. Mm. Whereas like we do need a level above that reserved for the companies who I don't really think you can trust with your money.
Yeah, it's interesting. Like if they see it working for EA and Activision, I'd expect them to 100% go that way for their shareholders.
Mm.
I'm actually very interested to see what happens with Anthem next year with EA.
Yeah, yeah.
Because like they'll be finalizing the monetization hooks probably as we speak for that game, and you know they're going to have plans for this, and I wonder if they're going to alter or change. Or
yeah, that I think is you know why I'm most interested to see, like, because ultimately, yeah, these things will probably make money anyway.
Hmm.
But traditionally, like, you know, a lot of this stuff comes down to not necessarily how much money you made, but how badly were your investors spooked.
Hmm.
And it could be that something like this is sufficient to spook investors. And even if EA fights a winning battle to turn around and say, yes, but look how much money we've made. I wouldn't be surprised to see if this had a knock-on effect in terms of what decisions do get made in the future. Because they did row back map pack subscription season passes, right?
Yeah, I wonder if that's because they actually saw how the audience numbers, the player numbers actually suffered based on those, dividing map pack things. Anthem's an interesting one because it's launching a brand new IP from scratch. And perhaps they might need to be more forgiving to get people on board with that before, you know, without actually going all in on the monetization straight away. It's just, it would be really interesting to see what they do.
Yeah, it will be. And, and also because that's BioWare, right?
Yeah.
So how's, yeah, I don't know. I don't
Who
know
knows? Why they're making the game. But what it'll be like.
Yeah. Okay. We spoke about the industry monetization practices for a good 40 minutes.
That was a lot of,
it was, but you know, it is the thing, right? Like, I do think it is the unresolved crisis.
And we have solved it now.
We have solved it.
It was worth it.
Another week on the Quake Crowbar.
Yep. I drank an entire can of beer and somehow ended up with no solutions. Despite everything I was promised.
That usually works.
Join me for my YouTube series, Beer Lies. what have you been playing, Tom?
I've been playing Injustice 2.
Oh, cool.
Gods Among Weasels, as my girlfriend calls it, for some reason.
Why does she call it that?
She just sort of said the word weasel.
What is it actually called?
Gods Among Men, I guess.
I mean, isn't it Gods
Among Us.
Gods Among Us. Among,
like Gods Among Wesley or something.
Wasn't the first one called Gods Among Us?
Oh.
Injustice, the first one was...
Injustice Gods Among Us.
Yeah. Which is, because it's not to be confused with The Wolf Among Us.
Injustice 2, Gods Still Among Us.
Speaking of confusion, is this... a superhero beat 'em up, or is it a thing about a guy who can fire lightning from his hands and like?
You're thinking of Infamous.
Yeah.
Okay. Injustice is a superhero beat 'em up.
Okay.
Yeah, so Injustice 2 Gods Humongous, is a game about all of DC's like bottom of the barrel, like C and D list characters beating the crap out of each other for the weakest reasons you can imagine, but with very, surprisingly well-produced cutscenes and things.
You should call it Unfamous.
Unfamous. You've got your Batmans, you've got your Supermans in there as well. I've heard of Batman, heard of Superman. But it's like when you run into a cutscene and suddenly like, it's like Ice Chap and Fire Fellow. It is I, Ice Chap, and I'm here with Fire Fellow.
I know exactly who you mean.
I've actually already forgot what, like, it is Ice.
Captain Frost. And depends, there's quite a few different firemen. There's a lot of different firemen.
Yeah.
if it's the one that's most commonly associated with Captain Frost, he's a Flash villain. Oh fuck. What the fuck is his name? Is Captain Boomerang in it?
Not yet, but there's every chance,
shame.
To be honest. I fought a giant ape that was hyper-intelligent.
Gorilla Grodd?
Yes.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
Well,
How many intelligent gorillas are there in superhero fiction?
Quite a lot.
And Overwatch did not invent the hyper-intelligent gorilla.
Overwatch didn't invent anything.
everything is taken. What I really enjoy about Injustice is that it's like a perfectly good beat-em-up, actually. Like, it's surprisingly more technical than it really, really needs to be for what it is. And also my total illiteracy in DC lore colliding with this like array of just bizarre characters that were probably like in a comic once in the 70s, perhaps, that everyone has forgotten about, but now is like been beautifully modeled in 3D with like astonishing facial animation and just bizarre, super, you know, finishes. It's I'm having a great time with it. It's so much awesome. Fun.
It just came out on PC, right?
It just came out on PC, day before yesterday, I think.
Oh, wow.
This week. But I've played it for like 4 hours solid because I was just so entertained by it. It's one of these, plots. So they're really good, at doing single player campaigns that make you give you the opportunity to play every single character. And yet they find a way for the story to make every single character fight every other character pretty much. Like it's a huge kind of Royal Rumble loosely tied together by a Brainiac world invasion plot that makes no sense, but is nonetheless like incredibly entertaining. And the cutscenes are just, the faces look almost mo-capped, but it's so, like, really weirdly uncanny valley. Like, I experienced a kind of weird Sartrean horror when I was watching Superman's lips move. And they're, like, sort of fleshy and reflective in the way that flesh would be, but also bulging and shrinking in a way that muscles just wouldn't do. And also, the movements have very little to do with the sounds coming out of his mouth. So I was just, like, watching Superman's lips in fascination. So they just kind of, like, rippled across his face. As he says, he's talking some just total nonsense about, you know, how he's in prison and Bruce Wayne has imprisoned him and he's cross about it and he wants to be let out so that he can beat up Brainiac, the bad guy. And, but all the while his lips are just going traveling around his face. It's just like, it's like two snakes trapped in a sock fighting each other. It just, all of this stuff is magic. It's my favorite game of the week.
Yeah, I think I saw actually, now that you mention it, some cutscenes from this just as like GIFs or something on the internet. And yeah, they were really impressive in terms of the digital acting. Like it had a really sort of naturalistic feel to the way people moved and stuff.
We had loads of fun with the first one back when we were
flat.
We
did it on console, didn't we? Yeah. Flat. And yeah, it's all the same systems and stuff. So it's all, it's very accessible special moves, just back forward a button. You know, quarter turn backwards and a button, and that does something for every character. And I really like that about this type of beat 'em up, where it's not trying to be hyper technical. There are depths to it if you want to explore it, but it's not trying to be Street Fighter. It's trying to be a game you play after the pub on the couch with your mates. Yeah. And I love that type of beat 'em up.
It's by, if you're not aware, it's by NetherRealm, who are the people who made the new Mortal Kombat games as well.
Right. Yeah.
And I always preferred it because it's like less grim.
Yeah, for sure.
It's got a loot system, right?
Oh, God.
It, too, has a loot system. And actually, it has very little to do with the single player, as far as I can tell so far. It seems to be much more of a multiplayer thing, where you can like level up and unlock boxes that give you bits of gear that you put onto your characters that do give you like very small incremental upgrades to, I don't know, like kicks and stuff. And that sounds like death for a beat-em-up, like a serious competitive beat-em-up to me. I heard
Edge's Nathan Brown praise the system. Oh, and he is a big Street Fighter purist, possibly one of the biggest I know. And so I think that bodes well. Doing a shrug.
I wish there was more dressed up in the single player, though, because that's the perfect place to do it, really. Well, it doesn't matter if you've got any sort of a real advantage of the AI. Like, if I can give Batman a silly hat while I'm going through the deeply stupid story that's happening, then, you know, I'm quite happy with that.
Because the first game had a deeply stupid story as well. And that does have a bit where Aquaman leads like an army of crabs to fight someone in Alcatraz, I think.
Yeah.
And like, has it gone there yet? Like, not Alcatraz specifically, or even army of crabs specifically, but like, you know.
Not to that scale, but it's definitely as stupid. Good. And there's no way it's not going to get to that point. I've already done the Aquaman bit. It's hilarious. It's brilliant. And again, like his face is amazing. Like they're really, it's like, I feel like I've met him.
Is it more or less convincing, do you think, than Jason Momoa?
Jason Momoa?
The actor playing Aquaman in Justice League, which is like out this week.
I've not seen the film. But I've only seen the trailers, and I would say that he's easily more convincing.
Okay.
he looks like a WWE wrestler to me in the film. Which maybe
he's
what
a really chill dude, Jason Momoa, in real life. It comes across really well in interviews and stuff. But that whole film, that's a weird thing. That must be why they're releasing it on PC this week, right?
Yeah,
like, because there's a Justice League movie.
Tapping into that stuff. It's going to be better than that film. I'm willing to bet.
Okay.
£5.
Down. Yeah.
I'll happily watch the Justice League film on a plane. in 8 months' time. Though actually, I severely underestimated Wonder Woman, which I watched on the plane.
It's good, isn't it? It's all right.
It's actually like a really fun adventure film until the final third, and then it just goes to...
It becomes spectacularly dumb.
Yeah. But
it's a good seven out of ten film.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think like the first two thirds were like, you know, 8 out of 10 blockbuster, and then it just shits itself.
Yeah. It's interesting. We're becoming a film podcast again.
Yeah.
But yeah, there was sort of, yes. I thought it was, yes, solid and all right and good more in principle than in practice, if that makes sense. Like, it's great that it exists for what it is. Like, isn't it great that the Wonder Woman film is better than the Batman film?
Right.
Right. And particularly because it's, you know, a Patty Jenkins movie as well. So that's really cool. But like, it's not great though.
No, but I enjoy like a sort of fish out of water, two disparate people trying to make their way through London phase of the film where it's all just beautifully shot and amazingly, the period kind of accuracy of it is just luscious and really satisfying. And there's a lot of, there's lots like, I love the island at the start as well, that their vision of, you know, that paradise that they live in is really cool.
Yeah.
And the way that that's shattered. There's loads of really cool stuff in that film apart from the
It reminds me about how like, the best parts of the Donna Superman films are the Clark Kent bits, which is the thing that the new DC cinematic universe is completely lost.
Yeah, it's like, really
because it's so uninterested in Superman ever being Clark Kent or
you know, just has no humanity whatsoever. One of my favorite scenes in cinema ever is Christopher Reeve as Clark Kent fighting a revolving door. Like he just fails to get out of the door. Like he's fucking Superman and he's just exiting his building. And, yeah, he has a prolonged fight with it. And it's like his glasses fall off and he puts them back on and he's all bumbling. He tries to go backwards through the revolving door. It doesn't work. So he turns around. He's got to get like, carried along by it. It's just an amazing piece of slapstick comedy. Brilliant.
Yeah, I do think, oh God.
Films. Anyway.
I did think that Thor Ragnarok kind of sent up how much fun superhero films are allowed to be in a way that it's really hard for those DC films to catch up with now, I think.
Is his theme tune in that film a bit like Wonder Woman's theme tune?
What?
When I was in Thor Ragnarok, every time there's like a sort of iconic Thor moment, the theme tune that plays really reminded me of the Wonder Woman one.
Isn't it Immigrant Song by Led Zeppelin, Thor?
Don't know.
It is. So, well, that's kind of interesting because so
let's get into this. This is the important thing.
This is actually fascinating. I'm not going to get into too deep because we are a video games podcast. But so they do finally use Immigrant Thong song that Cisco Led Zeppelin mashup you didn't know you wanted is used extensively in Thor Ragnarok, which is such an obvious choice for Thor that you know it's kind of they got there eventually. But the Wonder Woman theme, which was actually created for Batman vs. Superman, which is not a good film. I've forgotten the name of the... It's a famous cellist who plays it and who composed it, I believe. I think composed it. But it's a really interesting piece of sound design because it's deliberately anti kind of traditional masculine soundtrack, hero soundtracking. Like it's sort of... really interesting in how it's composed. And I read something really interesting about it and I'll send the link for the show notes if I can remember where the fuck I read that. But it's a really interesting piece of musical choice making. So it's kind of interesting that you'd link it to, kind of a bit of classic Viking prog hard rock.
Yeah. But, I expect if I heard them next to each other, I'd be able to tell you what was different, but.
Anyway, what were we talking about? Injustice 2.
Injustice 2. Better than most of the films from DC, I would say. More fun. And most of those films deeply lack a sense of fun and a sense of humour.
Do you think on PC you'd miss the kind of couch multiplayer thing that the original was so good for?
Definitely. You certainly miss that. And also, it just drops to 30 frames a second for loads of stuff.
Shit.
And I'm fine with cutscenes doing that. It's just like I'm used to that. But this happens for the special moves. So you're playing like a... You know, beautifully smooth, 60 frames per second. Looks great. Big visual upgrade on the first game. And then you'll activate like a mega move. And these are hilarious. They're just really over the top execution, you know, visualizations of the hero's, you know, most powerful abilities. So you've got Green Lantern who just like puts himself in a giant green mech suit, which he's imagined. And then, you know, every time he imagines a new bit of it, he hits the person with it first. So he's like, oh, I need some gloves. So he hits them with the gloves and then puts them on him. And then his helmet appears in midair and he hits with the helmet and then the helmet goes on him. And then he points both of his giant gun arms at the guy and blasts them. And that's the sort of stuff that you're getting. But when you activate one of these, it drops into 30 frames per second is really, really awkward and like kind of gross. Like,
that's grim.
I don't mind frame rates really. I don't really care about them unless they're changing all the time. Yeah. And then it's just really disconcerting and horrible. And so it's a real shame that that's a problem with it. So yeah, honestly, probably would recommend you get it on console really, because couch is where it belongs.
It is, yeah. It is a great drop in, drop out. Couch beat 'em up. Yeah, it is. What is the best super move beat 'em up thingy?
I like the Green Lantern one. Slightly let down by the Batman one.
What does he do? Because he runs people over the Batmobile in the first one.
Yeah, I love that one. That was really good. In this one, they do a kind of homage to... What was the film where they use like a skyhook? He uses a skyhook to...
The Dark Knight.
The Dark Knight, where he dangles a guy out the window and the Batplane comes and takes him away.
Oh, yeah, the Fulton balloon extraction
thing. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So they Fulton balloon extract with the Batmobile and it goes up in front of the moon and then the Batplane flips over and drops the guy and then shoots them with loads of missiles.
Does the Batplane form the Bat symbol against the moon?
It does.
Like in the 1989 Tim Burton Batman film.
I love that film, man. Yes, it does.
it's the only reason you flew up there, isn't it, Bruce?
and then it shoots them with loads of missiles with bullets. It's like,
oh no,
it's not really a Batman
thing. Full Zack Snyder Batman.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Actually, no, to be completely fair, the 1989 Batman movie does involve the Batplane. After it silhouettes itself in front of the moon, it then strafes a carnival.
That's really true. Yeah. And then the Joker shoots it down with one pistol shot. Yeah. With the biggest pistol. I do like that film. It's ridiculous. Yeah,
it's weird.
It's very strange. Yeah. Very strange film.
Yeah, that's a shame, because they're running people over the Batmobile. I mean, to be fair, it's not like running people over the Batmobile wasn't also
It's weird, like blunt force trauma just seems less believably lethal than...
Yeah,
it's
like everything is a scaled up blackjack, right? Yeah. Like, it's ultimately just, you know, clubbing people on the head.
If all of his guns fired anvils, it would be fine. That's sufficiently blunt that it wouldn't really kill anyone.
It's like, I was watching Logan, and again, I did a whole session on this plane. Like, I went through every fucking superhero movie I've not seen. And I was like, oh, well, that's what Wolverine's claws do to people if, you know, you're actually going to show what those claws would do to people. And which is one of the things I actually like about the film.
Yeah, yeah.
I got a plane journey tomorrow, so I got this to look forward to.
Yeah, just mopping up superhero films.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. No, that sounds great. Although I kind of want to just play it on a couch now.
I'd recommend.
Actually, I mean, to be fair, people own Steam Links.
That's true.
Right. They own them. Maybe this is a good excuse to crack it out. What have you been playing, Tom F?
I've been playing Shadwen, unlike everyone else, because I don't think anyone plays that game. This is a game from Frozen Byte, who did Trine. And I had heard of it, but I didn't actually play it until recently when I was going through a document of game ideas, a big list of like things I'd like to try someday. And one of them just says, stealth game with rewind, brackets, someone has to do it. And before investing too seriously in that idea, I thought, I'm just going to Google stealth game with rewind and see if there is one. And there is, and it's called Shadwen, which I had heard of. And I thought it was, the things I knew about it was, I think I knew it was by Frozen Byte, you're like a thief lady, but you have like a young girl following you, and you have to kind of like worry about her getting detected as well. And I think I knew it had some kind of time fuckery, but I think the thing I'd heard was that it has super hot time, which it does, and super hot time being time only moves when you do. It is, but it does also have rewind, and that is, like, it's mentioned, but it's, like, number 7 in the list of crazy fucking features this game has. It's a wildly overambitious game, I think, and it kind of shows in that it's pretty... just has the feel of a game whose budget was not in line with its ambitions, and it's set in, like... medieval times. I was going to say thief times, which is not really a time, but it just has that. It's obviously modeled after Thief, and it has that kind of vibe of it will never be daylight in this world, for example. It's way better than I expected. I was interested in playing it just because of the rewind thing, which is great. But it also has like a fully proper physics-based grappling hook. It has physics-based, like, stealth and distraction stuff. So it's all about, like, moving crates by nudging them and stuff to create enough noise to distract guards. And all of this works with rewind and with super hot time. And, Yeah, it's actually really good. It has a load of interesting things about it. One is, so like stealth game with rewind, I think that's a good concept for a game, and that should be the entire concept for the game. And the way you know I think this is good is because that's what I wrote in my ideas document. What they did is that plus grappling hook, plus super hot time, plus manage an AI comrade in a stealth game, which is, I think, way too much, and it kind of shows. But all of those things individually, they sort of did a pretty good job of, like the grappling hook. A proper 3D grappling hook, a rope that like wraps around things that you can swing in any direction. You can attach it to any wooden surface, so it's semi-restricted, but not very restricted. There's a lot of wooden stuff around. And you can attach it anywhere on those wooden surfaces and do whatever you like from there. I think there's a reason that it's not done very often, which is in very short order, you can make it do something weird. You can sort of glitch into something or like wrap yourself too tightly, or there's just really no way to model what happens to a human when you sort of like fall from a great height and then shoot your grappling hook into a floor and then the rope wraps around a balcony, but then you're attracting the rope. So you kind of slip over the balcony and suck yourself into the floor. Like, and I think this game does the, if you're going to do that, Shadwen does the best handling of it, which is like, well, fuck looking right. We're just going to let that work. Like if it feels like it should work, if you were like a floating sphere, then it should work. And we won't worry about like, oh, this would mean the character's leg gets caught on this balcony, or like, this would be an awkward thing physically. They just make it happen and it looks fucking ridiculous. You're just always this like stiff. Your character has, this is one of the ways in which it feels like a game whose ambitions were out of match, with its budget. Your character just has this frozen expression at all times. They're just staring wide-eyed straight forwards, and no matter what you're doing, which is fair enough. It's like a behind third-person view, so you don't usually see your character's face. But if you do enough crazy shit with a grappling hook, you end up seeing your character's face, and she always just looks like, what am I doing? Why have I done this? The only reason you ever see her face, really, is because while you're in these ridiculous situations, you sort of stop. And that stops time. You're not moving anymore. So time doesn't move, and you can then spin around the camera and watch yourself. Like, I'm just sort of doing a sort of superhero pose towards a guard with my rope attached to the ground beneath his feet. And he's just looking at me in utter astonishment. And I'm just staring into space. Like, I don't know why I'm doing this either. And then like managing an AI sidekick in a stealth game sounds like a recipe for disaster. This sounds like the worst idea in the world. But it actually works. And it ends up being the key to a bunch of interesting things that it does for a stealth game. For one thing, I'll just like going back to the rewind thing, rewind plus stealth is just awesome. I'm really glad someone did it. And to be honest, this hasn't even put me off doing it myself because it's so good that it's just like, I don't care if someone's already done this. This just works so well. Like I dropped down behind a guard and he heard me land. I didn't know he would hear me land. Like whether or not people hear you land is a thing that changes from game to game.
Yeah.
But because it has rewind, I just rewound 1 second and then that mistake was undone and it was no big deal. And so I just learned a rule with no consequences. And then I saw some straw nearby and I thought, I wonder if I land on the straw, if that's like a soft landing, he won't hear it. And so I tried it and he didn't hear it and it worked perfectly. So I learned like two rules and I went from failure, like annoying failure, to satisfying success in literally like 2.5 seconds. Right. It's just so fast to learn from your mistakes, learn how the world works. Every possible rule, even ones that are like a bit bullshit, because you can learn them so easily. It's just, oh, I'm fine with that. Okay. And then your companion. So you are Shadwen. That's your name. And I think one of the reasons that if I was brought in as like a consultant on promoting this game, I'd have many, many things to say. One of which would be, that's a really awkward name to say. They are a Finnish developer. I don't know if that name kind of either is a real Finnish name, I suspect not, or if it like rolls off the tongue better to a Finnish ear, but it sounds really awkward to me. I think the reason it sounds awkward is I can't help thinking that it started as like someone called Gwen decided to become a stealth character. Like, how can I put Shadow in Gwen. My name? Well, I can't, but here goes. So you are Shadwen, and then you have a little girl called Lily who's sort of attached herself to you. Like, you kind of save her early on and she just decides she wants to follow you around. You don't really want her to, but she's going to. And you don't control her directly. You just are Shadwen for the whole thing. But you you have the kind of command of the space that you have in something like Dishonored, where it's basically pretty easy to get anywhere because you can just grapple up to these wooden beams that go over everything. You can stay high, stay out of sight. Enemy vision cones are pretty small. There's loads of hiding places. And so you can just traverse the space really expertly and have a perfect overview of everything. You can optionally see enemy vision cones. I've turned that on. It's like a difficulty option. That's really cool. So you're never, like, getting through the space is not a challenge for you, but Lily has to get through the space as well. And the way she works is she will just go to, like, the nearest bush or haystack, which count as, like, perfect stealth areas that no one can ever see you when you're in there. And she will move to the next haystack, or bush, as soon as she can see there's a clear path, or even if she thinks there kind of might be a clear path. And then the really smart move they made is that you can never fail from her getting detected. If someone sees her, she just runs back to where she was, and they don't actually see her in the real sense. She just get, like, scampers away. Whereas if they see you, it's game over and you have to rewind. And so you never fail because of her. Like, she can't really do anything wrong. All she can do is fail to get to the next hay bale and then go back. And the AI for her doing that, I think it's just sort of like, looks for a path that doesn't pass through any enemy vision cones, and as soon as that is true, she will start going for it, which sounds like a perfectly logical way to do this, but in a stealth game, the way she behaves, you're watching her as almost like another stealth player, and she is so ballsy. She's just like absolutely no fear. Like, the second, like, a guard's looking right at her, and the second he like turns around to get back to where he was, she just runs out past him, even though there's like three other guards about to turn around, but she just thinks, yeah, I might make it, who cares. And so it's actually like, it makes you kind of like her a lot. Just this really gutsy little kid who'll just go for anything, has no fear, until she's seen, in which case you scampers back to where she was hiding from.
What they've done there is they've made a better system than The Last of Us, where you are stealthing around a lot with Ellie, and Ellie's approach, you know she's fully out of your control, is just to just wander around fucking anywhere in front of guards, and they're programmed not to see her. Like, it's so strange, and it's kind of one of the most broken aspects of the game, really, because it really is a game all about creating an atmosphere, and it just shatters it as soon as she does
I remember seeing her just go straight in front of enemies, and they just don't.
They're just like, must be a rat.
It's still a better way of doing it than having you actually fail the game.
Agreed.
Yeah. Like, I think all developers have got together in some kind of secret meeting and decided, we just can't do that. That's just such bullshit. We can't ever do it.
Absolutely.
And so Lily, the Shadwen system only really works because the levels have a concept of progress. Like, they don't feel linear, but they are linear. They're like, this bush is further forward than that bush. And so Lily knows she should go to that bush if she can. If you had a non-linear level, she would have to have some kind of decision-making process for which bush is it preferable for her to get to.
Right.
Is this one further forward than the other one? And that would depend on like what route the player was planning to take it through or whatever. It pretty much has to be, there is a route through this level, and she will always go to the hiding spot that's further forwards. And like I say, she's really good at it. Like, you kind of, I end up like, sometimes I'll spend some time. So the way you kind of get past guards is mostly by distraction. You can kill them if you get the jump on them, but I'll come back to that. I've tended not to, because you can fire a grappling hook into like some crates and then just pull them down, and that will make the guards all run over to where those crates were and say, oh, what is this? Dark forces. Why did that move?
Ropes.
Yeah, they can't see the rope ever. Even if they're looking right at the crate and you fire a rope into it and then pull it, and it's like, why is it moving? And that works really well, just as like a sort of a neat distraction tool that you can just use as much as you like. And so it's all about like, oh, this guard's covering this exit. So he's covering the path from this hay bale to this bush. I will pull this crate behind him. And then when it lands, he'll hear that. He'll turn around. Then Lily runs from one bush to the next. And often I will like jump down to that bush as well to hide. And sometimes when I do that, like, she is already gone to the next one. Like, she's found a way to get to the next one. I haven't even figured that out. I'm like, oh, shit, okay, if we can go, I'll go. And I'll, like, run after her. So that works really well. A thing that didn't become clear to me for ages, not for ages, for until level two, was, so you can, the first time you even meet Lily, that she's being confronted by a guard, and the obvious way to deal with him is to kill him. And I did that. And then it popped out the message saying, oh, Lily's seen you brutally murder someone. This will affect the story. If you want to undo this, you can rewind. And so I rewound, because it seemed to be implying I shouldn't have done that. And then I just found some kind of really cheesy way to get him to look the other way for a second. That completed the scene, and then we moved on. And because of that, I have always been trying to avoid killing, because it seemed to be like, oh, if you kill, Lily thinks you're a bad person, and I know from Dishonored, I will just be outright punished for this. It'll just tell me at the end of the game, you did the wrong thing, you're bad, this is a bad choice.
Lily thinks you're radical.
Yeah, a little credit. That was a cool kill. Anyway, surprisingly, it's one of the few stealth games I've ever played where I'm actually happy to do not just non-lethal, but don't even take out the guards. You know, usually I'm all about at least make the space safe, take out everybody so that I don't have to worry about the patrols anymore.
Like Tom Francis' safe spaces is a different interpretation.
Everyone here is unconscious. That's a safe space. in this one, I don't feel that need because it's so easy to get across the space. Like, you can just go up in the rafters. Kind of like the Arkham games. You know, there's so many gargoyles up high. Yeah. You can just trivially evade everybody forever. And you can do that here. And then getting Lily through, once she gets past a section, she will never have to go through it again. And that's cool. And then I got to, I actually ended up, I was pulling a crate down to distract someone, I landed on them and killed them. And I kind of laughed at that, and I thought, you know, I'm not like going for a strict non-lethal run. I only rewound because it told me Lily's heart was broken. Basically, there's like a little heart icon that breaks when she sees you kill someone.
Wow.
And that didn't happen this time, so I just kind of carried on and thought, oh, that was kind of funny happenstance.
She loved that one. Now,
well, I didn't think about this afterwards, but in retrospect, thinking back on it, she didn't see that. And when I realized that, I suddenly thought, shit, this is like. I was in another situation where it was really hard to get past these two particular guards, and it was in a section where I was only going to the section to open a door for Lily, so she couldn't get into the section yet. I had to unlock the door from the other side, and there's two guards in here, and it's very hard to get them out of the way properly. And so I thought, well, she can't see this. I can just kill them. And so I killed them. And then I actually did it as a test, because, you know, the fact that I can rewind any time means I can experiment infinitely and just try every possible thing with no consequence. And so I just thought, well, I'll try killing him and see if there is a body dragging system, because if I can drag these bodies out of the way, then when Lily comes through, she never needs to know there are ever any guards here. It was just a very safe, easy room.
Safe space. Exactly. No one could be offended if everyone's dead.
So I tried it, and sure enough, you can drag bodies. Mm. And so I killed them both, and I just dragged them up to some little corner that I could see from the route that you'd have to take through the space that she would never see, and then let her through. And this is like the coolest body hiding stealth detection system I've ever used, because you know, in most stealth games it's just kind of become like body getting detected is not that big a deal. Usually it is in this, they set off an alarm and that eventually ends the game, but usually it's just like games have a real hard time getting away from like the mechanics reward or punish this, therefore you just do or don't do that.
Yeah.
And so you just end up with a playstyle and you just do that forever and you never vary from it.
Yeah.
And this is the first time where I'm like, I was doing a non-lethal playthrough, and then I realized my logic for doing that was actually based on what Lily thinks. And if I can get away with it from Lily's perspective, I kind of have a clean slate. I don't think the game is going to ever judge me.
That's
for
amazing.
This.
Yeah, that's really, really cool.
And that's way more interesting. Like, hiding a body from a friend is way more interesting than hiding bodies from enemies.
Yeah.
It's kind of like you should be able to, a bit like trying to get a childhood pet's death past a child.
Yeah.
Like, replace the guard with, like, you or your mate, like, pretending to be
in
the guard. Wig. Like, oh, I'm fine, but I'm just going to look over here.
That's one of the reasons I like it so much, is it feels like a kind of parental thing to do. It actually makes me think that I would love to see something like this with Emily and Corvo, because Corvo's your dad, and he's kind of, he would be trying to protect you from the evils of this world, and he also feels like the kind of guy who would maybe do this, maybe sometimes see the necessity of just, this person has to die, I don't want you to know they have to die, I'm just going to tell you there was no one in this room. And yeah, so it feels parental, like what you're doing is in a weird way, is a very dark and strange parent. The rest of the game I've been showing her that, like, we can just get through this, we'll just distract the guards, we won't hurt anybody. And then when she can't see, I'm just like, fucking stab this fucking hay bale. And like, oh, yeah, this area is clearly, come with me.
Corvo would like sneak into a room, summon rats to eat everybody, and then open the door and be like, Emily, look, another room full of lovely rats. Now, we can't keep them, so make sure you say goodbye.
I like that's an extra layer of challenge as well, that it's like a secret stealth mission within the stealth missions that you're already doing as well. It's like those shmups that do that, where there are hidden objectives that actually give you that extra difficulty level.
Yeah. There's like chests lying around that, I wouldn't call them loot chests, but they do have, ingredients in them that you can use to craft gadgets and stuff. That system doesn't really work that well because most of the gadgets are lethal and you're just strongly encouraged not to kill, except in those particular circumstances. But
what if Emily learns to kill? If you do it often enough, those little scoots forward to cover become like murderous. Roots through the level.
The murder scoots.
Create nuts. A monster.
Power sliding through the guards. The problem it has is that it doesn't. That thing of distracting with the ropes and stuff, that was like level one, and level two was that again, but then I discovered this cool corpse thing. I've played like four or five levels on from that. The levels are quite long, so like 20 minutes or something. And it hasn't come up with anything new since then. It's just been that again and again and again. And the environments also look exactly the same. The guards are all the same. Mm. It's just recently introduced a guard that has like a shield in his back, which means you can't backstab him. But then I was almost never backstabbing anyone anyway. So that just made zero difference to my play. The killing people thing, I haven't actually done it again because it just hasn't been necessary. There hasn't been a situation where I'm like, oh, I don't know how to get past this guy.
So you're always just trying to get through the level.
Yeah, and get her through as well, which is trickier than you getting through. But thus far, it hasn't actually been that necessary to take people out. I might have done it like one more time, actually. But I kind of wish it was hard enough that I needed to do that because that was such an interesting choice to make. Was such a cool new kind of narrative theme for stealth. So far it just feels like it doesn't have any other tricks up its sleeve. And I think that's probably why it's not better known than it is. Yeah. Is that it just kind of, tries a lot of mechanics all at once. And then only a few of them end up being really relevant. And, those ones just get basically repeated, and it is satisfying. I'm having a good time and I will finish it, I think. Cause I will happily just do this kind of pull on that crate to distract that guard thing, on a loop forever. They should have cut like three of these mechanics and just stuck with like two or three of them. And then focused on what's an interesting twist for that. How do we make this harder? Like they've made attacking the guards harder, but they haven't made avoiding the guards harder in any way at all. It's just literally the same. So I think that would have been an interesting road to go down. But still really recommend it. It's even just like swinging around with super hot time. Like there's so many things going on in this game. It's completely nuts. But like you swing from one thing and while you're sort of pushing, I'm playing with a controller and while I'm pushing forward on the thumbstick, time is moving and I'm swinging. And then the second I think, oh, I want to swing to the next vantage point now, I just let go of the thumbstick and time is frozen. So I have as long as I like to like shoot my rope exactly where I want it to be and then do a perfect Tarzan thing. And then like launch myself into the air and like land perfectly on this other beam. And if I don't land perfectly on the beam, I just rewind a little bit and then slightly adjust it and get it right.
I want this in a Spider-Man game.
Yeah. And then stuff like Lily running from cover to cover. The only way that can really go wrong is if she does get spotted, she runs back and she runs all the way back. So even if there is a clear path after that, she won't check again until she's back in safety. And so that's a little bit of a consequence for her getting detected. And if that happens, what I'll usually do is instead of letting her run all the way back, I'll actually rewind time to before she got spotted and then see, okay, it's that guy who spots her. Is there something I could have done like 3 seconds ago that would mean by this time that guard is looking this way? And often there is, and that's really satisfying too.
Sounds great. How old is it now?
I feel like 2 or 3 years maybe.
Oh, wow.
Frozenbyte, everyone knows them for Trine, I think. Mm. And then there was a little bit of a controversy about Trine 3, I seem to remember. Like, they apologized for it at some point. Like, it was kind of unfinished. They had to scrap some big chunk of it. Is it Trine 3 or Trine 2?
They got it to 3, but...
Yeah, I don't know.
And I hadn't really heard of what they've been up to since then, except vaguely having heard of Shadwen. But they've done 2 games since that. They have one called 9 Parchments that's out now already on Switch and I think PC. Huh. And they had another one in between whose name I forget.
Wow. Should we do some questions?
Sure.
Yes.
So our first question this month this month, this week, comes from a little voice from our past.
Ooh.
Comes from Marsh.
Ah.
But I thought he died.
So did I, but apparently not. Well, he's alive enough to send us this email. And he writes, "Hello." Oh, sorry. I'll do the voice properly. Hang on. "Hello." "An early assassination mission in ass oranges concluded with my blade sinking cleanly into the neck of my foe, only to have a cutscene immediately interject, asserting that I in fact flubbed the attack and somehow cut off my own finger in the process. Obviously, this is obscenely dumb, but has there ever been a cutscene-induced forced fail or similar that wasn't obscenely dumb? Yours, Orangesly, Marsh!"
God, it's like he's in the room.
It's incredible. It's so good to hear from him after all this time.
I think that guy called me when I was a PC gamer.
Well, it's great to hear from Marsh. And he's obviously... So I suppose his, I forgot what his actual question is.
Has there ever been a forced fail cutscene that wasn't dumb?
Not as far as, I absolutely hate this. It's one of my pet peeves with games.
It's interesting because I remember that assassination in Assassin's Creed Origins and it didn't bother me. I'm usually very bothered by these kinds of things. I don't totally know why it didn't. It was, I think because it's not really a fail. You lose your finger, but you kill the guy. So you did kill the guy. And the fact you lost your finger has no gameplay relevance. That's just so,
a net win.
A story to tell. But, you know, see again, you know, whereas like...
Eye for an eye, that's a bad murder deal. Finger for a guy.
Finger for a guy.
There you go.
Sounds good to me. He even says that, like, not quite in those words, but by excess.
That's the first version of the Assassin's Creed. It's like, eye for an eye, finger for a guy.
That's a very different game. Yeah. He muttered something afterwards, like, I think it's even just as you're wandering around the world, he says something like, it was worth the cost to end the hyena.
You shook your fist then, but that wouldn't really work as well.
You could shake most of your fist. Prototype 2 had the worst of these, where I've been chasing a boss throughout a level, and every time he gets too far from you, it insta-fails the mission. You have to restart it, which already is ultra, ultra bullshit.
Mm.
And then, if you chase him for long enough, it triggers the cutscene. Like, if he's going to a certain location, and obviously the cutscene takes place at this location, so you have to reach there for the cutscene to play, and the cutscene is him getting away from you. It's like, oh, for fuck's sake, that just happened, like, 7 different times, and you told me that was unacceptable, and I had to restart. And now you tell me that's what happens anyway?
The rifle butt to the face is the laziest kind of cutscene interrupt I've seen. God, so many times in so many games where you're in first person and then you go through a doorway and then the rifle butt comes in and then it's fucking terrible.
I don't know if it counts, but in terms of like getting to your objective, then a cutscene happens and your character does something that is totally not what you intended. I would say the Andrew Ryan moment in BioShock fits that.
Okay.
It's not a forced fail. It depends what your goal was. But your character just goes totally off piste and does something that you did not tell him to do in a really dramatic way. And it's obviously very intentional and there's a narrative reason why he is not obeying you at that point.
That is a successful force fail because it's set up by the entire game.
I was about to say, it only took the entire game to set up that one moment. Yep. But then it works. Any other context, maybe not.
I think there are... I mean, games can put you in interesting negative circumstances where you don't succeed as much as you thought you would.
Yeah, but it's to me, like, a cutscene is not meaningful friction. It's just a waste of time. And especially when, you know, it just undermines... If the game gives you an objective and then it undermines it with a cutscene of which you have no control and it takes all your powers away. And in fact, the most infuriating ones show people doing stuff to your character that your character would just shrug off in the ordinary game environment. Yeah. They've got powers and stuff that would just let them escape from
the situation. I do have this issue with the Mass Effect series, actually, because there's a bunch of... I think Mass Effect 3 has a couple where, like, Shepard just needs to fall down a bunch for the drama to proceed, for the bad guy to get away with the thing or to, you know, whatever, right?
Yeah.
And you spend so much time, like, doing, like, combat roly-polies away from explosions in that game that it doesn't it literally doesn't land when it wants you to believe that, like, I've been momentarily inconvenienced by a shove.
Right.
And, you know, that's an, I mean, I pick on Mass Effect, but that's an endemic problem.
There's also, Mass Effect, as soon as you're in a cutscene, you're always holding this pistol that's, like, sometimes, I think in the first game, it could even be just a weapon you don't even have. And if someone gets shot by, like, a pistol in a cutscene, that's them dead. Whereas in actual combat, it's like 90 assault rifle rounds. Do not take it down to half health.
I think Spec Ops The Line disadvantages you in interesting ways. But what it does is it gives you the cutscene that kind of takes your power away, but then it follows up with an interesting decision. So when you actually come back into the game, you actually often have a choice about who to shoot after what's just happened. Or if you're surrounded by a bunch of people on the bridge and you're told to walk slowly forwards and not pull your gun, you can actually pull your gun. Like, it actually gives you, it follows up the interactivity afterwards.
Yeah. The, actually, so one I really do like is the end of Halo Reach.
Mm.
I don't know if you've played Reach or
no,
the end.
Reached
So I'm going to spoil the end of Halo Reach, but, it's been a long time and this is a PC podcast. It's a content card. So skip ahead a minute if you don't want to have the end of Halo Reach spoiled. But Reach is a really interesting game because it's the Halo prequel. It's like the prequel to the original Halo trilogy.
Mm.
And it's set, during the fall of Reach, which is this, it was the first planet to be consumed by the war that the rest of the Halo games are about. And the idea is that it was Reach where all of the Spartans, which are the super soldiers that Master Chief is, die. So you go into that game with the knowledge that, like, something has to happen. And a lot of games have sort of, you know, I always thought that, like, things like the Star Wars prequels had the same problem of, like, we know you have to be rid of these characters by the end of this.
Yeah.
And it ends, the last thing you do in the game is hold off waves and waves of enemies so that the ship carrying frozen Master Chief can escape the planet and go on to begin the Halo trilogy, which is a nice kind of handover between the two. You never see him, but you get that kind of thing. And you've made your own character at the start because you can make your own because it's not a preset character. And then huge bomb goes off or something and you think you've died, like, as you need to at the end of the game, which would be your forced fail ending because you go into the game knowing that you are dead. Right? You have to die for the rest of the story to happen. But what's really cool is that right before, I think it's not even, I remember it as feeling like a post-credit sequence, but I don't think it is. I think it's just like the epilogue of the game, is you actually wake up in the aftermath of the explosion and you're in the same level that you were, but it's kind of like blasted to pieces and there's really heavy sand clouds all around you and you can barely see. And you are down to just your pistol, basically, and like one clip of ammo and there's nothing else in the gun. And you have nothing else left and there's no other ammo to find. And there are alien enemies wandering the environment, similarly shell-shocked. Basically, like, you know, everyone's sort of dead. And you can basically just play that level for as long as you can survive.
Right.
And that's it. That's the end of the game. You just play that level for as long as you can. And you, because you have really limited ammo, but you still have your melee attack and stuff. So you can keep going for a while if you hide a lot and stuff. But you will eventually die because eventually more enemies will come and, you know, kill you. And whenever you finally die is when the game ends.
Hmm.
And it doesn't give you the regular death screen. It just zooms out from your helmet with a bullet hole in it in the sand and it kind of closes out and that's the credits. And I really like that as a because it's a forced fail in that, like, this is going to end with your death, but you kind of choose whether that's like a heroic last stand or, you know, or what, right? Hmm. Like, you get to kind of play out your final moments. I really, really like that.
Yeah, I really like that concept as an ending. There's Deus Ex has something similar, the first one, where it's not the end, but there's a section of the game where, like, at any time after this point, the next time you die, you'll wake up in prison, basically, and the story will actually progress. And it's Deus Ex has a degree of choice, but ultimately it's going to push you down one particular path right to the end of the game, and then at the end you get the sort of the decisive choice. But along the way you can sort of resist the course of the plot for a long time, and so this is one of the things you can resist. If you survive this fight, you can get through it, and then you can go to a whole different area, and then eventually you hit basically a brick wall, which is like a boss surrounded by a whole load of other bosses, and no actual way out of that situation. And at some point you're going to die, and when you do die, then you wake up in prison, and that's where the game carries on from.
Yeah, I think the key is it's not really a forced fail. It's sort of something that you have some degree of freedom over, even if the consequences.
It almost feels like it kind of mollified me, because, like, I was able to evade it a couple of times, so that by the time it finally happened, it was like, all right, I understand. You've given me a lot of leeway here. Like, I screwed you
long
enough.
You've allowed me to settle my affairs.
I realize the game just has to wait to have me wake up in prison, so.
Mm.
I love unusual fail states. That reminds me of, I think there's like, maybe in Dark Souls 2 and definitely Bloodborne, there are enemies that can kill you and you think you're just dead. And then things take like a massive right turn. Suddenly you wake up in prison or somewhere
else. We haven't got there in Bloodborne yet in our playthrough, which will return when we manage find time for it. But they're a big man put you in a bag.
Yeah.
Big man put you in a bag. And you don't know, we don't want that to have happened, but it has.
And
now you're in his house.
Just surprising failure states. So that's a massive untapped thing for me. I like the idea that you can, you just think you're going to die as normal and then respawn, but actually suddenly it takes you away somewhere or does something
different. I think a lot of those surprising. Like rifle butt to the face cutscenes could have been replaced with that. Like just enemies flooding in and they just keep flooding in until you die. And then when you die, that's when it happens. Cause then at least you feel you have some control.
Yeah.
Like,
I think games teach you that you can overcome any situation too much, though. Like, that's, you know, the end of Halo Reach. Like, you know, also the opening shot of Halo Reach is your helmet in the sand with a bullet hole in it. Mm. And the game ends on that shot as well. And it bookends the entire thing. And so you kind of know it has to end there. Mm. So you're kind of ready for it. You're like, I understand this is the end of the game. Whereas most of the time, you know, there's an interesting, on a different tack, there's an interesting, watch a lot of YouTube's about DMing and GMing and pen and paper RPGs generally. And there's an interesting, I can't remember the video, but it's talking about how like trying to push players into a situation where they give up is a really dangerous trap to fall into as someone planning a pen and paper campaign, because players will just fight and they'll fight to the death because they're not used to being confronted with things where the, because even though in a pen and paper game, particularly fleeing is always an option, you know, you have all this lateral freedom that you don't have in a video game necessarily.
Mm.
Even in those circumstances where people could say, I'd like to try and parlay, or I'd like to run away, or I'd like to hide. Most people will always lean into like, fuck it, I've won every other fight I've been in. I want to fight this one as well.
Yeah. I think you'll never persuade the player to not take on the fight, but you can make it so that it literally is unwinnable and they will die. And then when they do die, that's when you progress them.
Mm.
There's a Dawn of War 2 campaign, one of the expansions, I think, where I wish it had been that Halo Reach ending. It's the last stand of like the Blood Ravens and you're totally surrounded.
Oh yeah.
That's the most space marine death ever. It would have been amazing just to let you kind of fend off as many things as you could and then die gloriously.
I think that should be one of the standard endings for games. Like one where you die, but you sort of hold out for as long as you can. Right? And,
People only sing enforced fail does duty end.
Because there's like, if you don't do that, then you, basically you run the risk of a huge chunk of players will find it too easy and it's not climactic and another bunch of players will not be able to complete it and they will never get to the end and then they'll give up on the game unhappy. Like both of those things are incredibly bad and incredibly likely with any given end game challenge. Whereas if you have it take them to the point of failure and the failure is where the game ends, then everyone has that experience. Everyone is pushed to the brink of their skill, the brink of their talents. They will have, if they've never had it in the whole game until that point, they will have the moment where they're using all of their skills and all of their resources and it's still, for a while, only just enough and then eventually not enough.
Mm.
And that seems like a great place to end, except that the main character's dead.
It feels like as if the game needs to sort of recognize your sacrifice in some way, though. Like, if you've done really well, I think people want to be rewarded.
Yeah, exactly.
But if you do that, aren't good at it will feel like they were sort of denied the narrative payoff at the end of the story.
Yeah, it can't be too much of a fuck you if you don't do well, but
right, but
you can have some kind of like, it can just be reflected in some way. Just
Which is an interesting thing, right? It's an interesting narrative double binded dissonance, you might say, in games, is that you kind of want to tell the whole story, the whole heroic movie style story, beginning to end, regardless of how good the player is at the game. When games are inevitably a challenge medium, so the kinds of games we're talking about are inevitably about challenge to some degree, where people can express skill greater or lesser as they play through.
Yeah, yeah.
But they have to be protected from the real consequences of that narrative. So you can, which is that every game is like this, right? Where you're a boinging chump that can't really do anything properly the first time and requires three goes to complete the most basic interaction with the door, but you will finish this as the savior of the universe rather than being ignored and passed over in favor of someone competent. And so, you know what I mean? That kind of, you kind of want someone to commit to making the action game where it actually really matters how good you are at it. Like they're not going to put you on the spec ops squad if you are crap.
Especially in a game like Dawn of War, where there are literally leveling systems and you kill things to level, and then suddenly you're in a position, like the game has taught you and trained you for the entire time to just kill things and be good at it. And then being not good at it in the end and being forced to fail is never going to feel good, I don't think, in that context. As much as I'd have loved it from a fiction perspective.
Well, thanks to Marsh for getting in touch.
Hello, Marsh.
Letting us know he's all right.
Woo, Marsh.
Woo, Marsh. Next is Neil. I'm not going to do the voice for Neil because I don't know what Neil sounds like. Neil writes, reskin an entire game with Star Wars to make your ideal Star Wars game. This comes from watching Rebels and imagining Far Cry, Lothal, Neil, which is a real cool idea. And to explain for people who don't watch, like I do, children's cartoons, that's basically a sort of Star Wars, it would be a game about unseating the Empire from a planet.
Mm.
Through a mixture of Far Cry style open world kind of drivey kind of activities, that'd be pretty good.
Yeah.
In fact, I'd go with XCOM, or as they should call it, X-Wing-COM.
Yeah.
But it wouldn't be about X-Wings, right? Or would it?
Yeah. It would just be about.
I thought you were talking about like on the ground.
Well, you could do both. Why not do both?
Yeah.
I mean, it's my magic game, Tom. I mean, why not a sort of Rebel Alliance simulator where you recruit people to the Rebel Alliance and send them out on missions, and maybe that's some space-based strategy. Maybe that's some ground-based strategy. That sounds pretty rad to me, that's, Chris.
Sounds super rad. I've already been satisfied by KOTOR in this regard. I absolutely love the idea of a Star Wars RPG. That's exactly what I want. I want to be in that world. I want to be in those canteens as someone just talking to people and bartering and getting cool weapons. And maybe there's a Jedi there too. You know, that is what I want from a Star Wars game.
Really. I actually found on an old USB stick only a couple of days ago, loads of my Star Wars Galaxy screenshots from 10 years ago. And it was actually like finding a lost family photo album. Genuinely, that's not a joke. That's a proper like, I had, there's feelings bound up in that that game and that place, and
you should load them into Facebook, because I don't really use Facebook, but my girlfriend does, and occasionally it serves up like just
your memories, yeah,
algorithmically generated.
Yeah,
God knows I'm sick of being shown pictures of university. So,
but the way that Facebook does it is that it kind of like picks some music and like does some fading photos from one to another, and it genuinely looks like everyone involved is dead. It's some sort of memorial.
I love that, because I've never really been like, I never really used Facebook properly. Like, I've had it for.
I've never used it properly.
More than a decade, but.
I only have an account for work.
Yeah, I have an account for miniatures events, basically. But like, I've got, but also like, you know, there were years where it was used a lot, like university and immediately afterwards and improv years and stuff like that. And so there's loads of pictures of me and, but it doesn't really have any value weighting on it. And particularly, I've never really interacted much with other people on it.
Mm.
And so it's constantly doing like this thing where it'll pop up like, you and your friend Ed have been friends on Facebook for 9 years. In that time, you've liked each other a lot. 12 times. You've had some great times together. And it's a picture of like Ed at a party in like 2008. And then in the background, talking to somebody else, you can see my ear. It's great. Times. I love watching the algorithm. Like,
just fuck it up.
I can't make your life meaningful.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, it's really, and like, the fact that you have to, like, you flip the little thing, like, I don't want to see this. And it's like, oh, why? And you're like, well, you've just done a, like, do you remember this person about, like, an ex or something? And you sort of, you know, like, and it's kind of like, oh, sorry, I'm not going to do that one again. Do you want to see this person? Do you want to see, would you click on this?
It's like a Rick and Morty episode, but, you know, actually real. It's just going to throw, like, random memories and hope that you like them or have emotional reaction randomly.
Yeah, I genuinely think as a species we've underestimated how much damage we've done to our own concept of time. Because nothing can ever die now. Mm. Nothing can ever end.
It's true.
No people can ever truly go away.
Mm.
Anyway, Star Wars.
Immortality, yeah.
So
I would apply the Star Wars paint to Papers, Please. And he's stamping like rebel or civilian papers and trying to detect rebels amongst them as a imperial.
Every now and then you'd get Obi-Wan Kenobi. You'd just inexplicably just do whatever the fuck amazing. He said.
That would be like how you become undone, is that you just, it seems like a perfectly normal person. And you just,
God, that would be boxes. So grim if it was like Papers, Please, in the, you get like the end of that day and you get in real trouble because you let him through, and therefore your family doesn't eat and you can't buy medicine. And you're like, oh, fucking hell. Yeah. Like, I got
fucking Jedi. Yeah.
Obi-Wan got his burger, so everything's fine.
His burger.
I don't know why I said that.
That's what Paper Spoons is about.
He uses it like in fast food restaurants in any way he really feels as though he can get away with it.
Good. Next. Donald writes, at the risk of saying the C word too early in the year, Christmas! Have any of you decided what games you will try to catch up on over the Christmas break yet? Donald.
I always feel like I try and save the super long form games, so like I want to do like a mega Total War Warhammer 2 merged map campaign. You know, they've released a patch that kind of glues all the first and second together into one huge campaign map. That's a great Christmas fodder. It's something you can just sink loads of hours
into. I'm waiting for, like, apparently it's got some rough edges and I'm waiting for them to iron it out, which might have happened by Christmas.
Mm.
That game's fucking great. Yeah, I didn't say this on the pod because it kind of like fell during a weird time, but I played a full like 40-hour Skaven campaign in Total Warhammer 2, and it's genuinely one of my highlights of the year. It's brilliant.
Yeah, it's fantastic. A great game.
I have been saving Horizon Zero Dawn expansion pack for that, because to be honest, I've done a pretty good job of keeping up with the massive onslaught of mega games in the last month, because they all came about a month after my game came out, which made me super glad I released my game. A, because I'm not competing with them, and B, because I have time to play them now. And so I played all of Wolfenstein, played level like 32 in Assassin's Oranges. And I feel like there's one other big one I played recently. I played like Mario Odyssey a bit. And so, yeah, Horizon's the only one that I haven't got to, and not because I'm not excited about it, but just because I'm right in the middle of Assassin's Creed Origins, and I think it's the one where, like, I know exactly what I'm going to get. I love that game, and I know what the expansion's going to be. The other one I was thinking about, actually, kind of out of left field, is Soma, because I played that, and I liked it, but I found it a bit of a slog with the horror sections, like when you're hiding from monsters. It just took a very long time to get through those, and it wasn't that much fun hiding from them. It was a little bit scary, but it wasn't like the scare factor wears off when it takes like 20 minutes to get past this one section. And there is a mod now that just makes the monsters non-hostile. And I really like the story of that game, and it was one of the few games that raises like philosophical issues and deals with them intelligently. And I recently saw a video that compared it to Tacoma and was talking about how they're both dealt with AI. And I thought, oh yeah, I don't care about spoilers because I'm never going to play that game again. And then I got like 15 minutes into it, I'm like, I'm going to play that game again. That goes to some really interesting places.
Right. Divinity Original Sin 2.
I think it's really good.
Yeah.
I'm really enjoying it, although it has given me the big town heebie-jeebies. Yeah.
That's why it's a good Christmas game, though, because you've got the time, perhaps, to sink into it, theoretically.
I'd like to play XCOM War of the Chosen.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
Because I did miss it, just because it was such a busy time. I'd like to finish Horizon, because I'm still playing that.
I've got the thing I do where I just don't finish a game because I'm enjoying it too much. That's the thing I've got with Horizon and Zelda at the moment. Like, I've got paralysis. Like, I don't want it to end because it'll make me sad.
Yeah, yeah. So feel that way with both of those games, actually. Yeah.
I feel like there's no danger of that with me and Zelda. Like, I could sink many more hours into it without any risk of that.
Next, Paul writes, hello, Creighton Crowbar people, he says, bravely abdicating the pun, which I respect.
That's totally
fine. Not necessary. Yeah. It's been 4 years. It's okay. We have run out. I've been anticipating the release of the new BattleTech game and looking over the spread of games over the last decade. The genre never really disappeared, but became quite niche and has been enjoying a bit of a comeback lately. It's got me wondering, if there are any game genres that truly do die and do not get cut up with our endless remake pendulum cycle? Can you think of any particular examples? If not, do you think that games as a medium is insulated from this kind of genre loss? Keep making these beautiful pods. All the best, Paul. Incidentally, I could say, Tom, are you playing The Sims 4?
No.
Because I've got Origin open, and it just popped up saying, you are playing The Sims 4.
My girlfriend is playing The Sims 4. Here's what is happening there. She loves it. Sims 4 is brilliant, by the way.
Yeah, it's good. I can say, so I don't know how embargoed I am on BattleTech, because I played it last week. Probably quite embargoed.
Probably quite embargoed, I would say.
I trust that I can get away with saying, I think it's pretty good.
Hmm. I've heard that on the grapevine.
I'm quite looking forward to it. I won't say anything else. And because I assume they won't be offended by me having said that. But maybe in the future where you're listening to this, I've been very sued. Anyway, I don't think this can happen. I don't think genre can die.
Well, once upon a time, I played a game called Space Ace. And Space Ace was on the Amiga, and it was basically an animated cartoon with QuickTime button presses. And that technically was a genre for a period where that was spectacular. And the animation was like, oh, I was blown away by it as a kid. It was amazing. It
was
like
one for the Sega CD that was very similar.
And occasionally, like, there are games that have been like that. There's a Ninja something game that was like this, like...
I guarantee you, if you go searching in the right places, or even the wrong places, you will find a Flash game that does that.
I mean, maybe. It depends what the premise of the question are. Like, is the genre dead? I feel like it is. That type of game is dead.
My view would be, games are so big now that nothing can truly die. Hmm. Like,
I wonder, maybe like one way of defining dead would be like, if a developer says, oh yeah, I'm making a game in this genre, do you tell them, no, for fuck's sake, don't.
What in God's name would you make a turn-based RTS?
I think you're right, Chris, that there's no old game that any of us would remember that there isn't somebody somewhere remaking it or making something in that vein because they love it so much. And so, like, no one ever making a game of that genre ever again, that criteria is never met. But maybe there's a sort of softer criteria of, like, well, no one really makes games like these anymore because there's just no kind of market for them. The one that sprung to mind for me was Crusader No Remorse, which is not a genre in itself, but isometric action would be a genre. I can't really think of one of those. There's loads of isometric strategy games, but this was a real-time... I think of it as like almost a proto Deus Ex, because it was... you're kind of breaking into offices. It was more action-y than Deus Ex. You were mowing people down, but you also had these kind of like remote control spider mines that you could steer around to like strategically blow up the right bits of the environment and shoot pipes to make jets of flame come out and set people alight and turn valves to blow things up and stuff like that. Like really complex destructibility, security systems and all that stuff. But yeah, from an isometric point of view, which, and to be honest, no great tragedy that's gone because I love that game to bits, but I think all the good bits were taken by Deus Ex, and the isometric thing was a fucking nightmare. The controls are so fiddly and awkward.
Then you still got like, you know, stuff like Commandos, remember? Obviously they weren't like action games, but they were kind of like semi-emergent, you know, stealth action scenarios. And that was, you know, Tom, I think you were enjoying like a version of Commandos that came out like in Japan.
Shadow Tactics.
So
yeah, that lives. What is that? That is real time. I honestly can't remember. You can't pause and issue orders in that game, at least. I think maybe you can pause, but you can't issue orders in it. And yeah, that's like very stealth though. It's like, the whole thing is about stealth, whereas Crusader was basically an action game. It had emergent elements, but it was primarily action. Something like Brigador might be the closest modern.
Oh yeah,
Brigador, Doctor,
which is a isometric mech action game that's very much about blowing everything up, as far as I understand it.
Man, I don't want to talk about BattleTech, but can't. I still stand by the notion that I don't think, like, the thing we talked about last week about indie studios and indie sequels suffering is it feels like one of the keys to success at the moment is showing up with something that people don't realize they wanted, whether that's something genuinely new or it's a revival of something that people have kind of been waiting to come back for a while. And the positive thing about indie development at the moment is that it does seem like lots of different ideas can succeed as long as they're sufficiently novel. And in that context, I think it's really difficult to say that any genre is completely dead.
Yeah.
I think there are some things like flight simulators that have retreated into their niche, but I would be surprised if the number of people playing them had gone down.
Yeah, yeah.
It's just the games are so much bigger. right?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting thing. Like, in the heyday of flight simulators, really, like when I got into PC gaming, flight simulators were certainly one of, perhaps even the popular genre. Like, that was kind of where the headlines were being made, and the cover of PC Gamer in the month that a big flight sim came out would be that flight sim, and it would get 90%, and it would be a huge deal.
Yeah.
And I think you're probably right that all those people who played those are still playing flight sims and still having new cool flight sims to play. It's just that that number is not dramatically increased, whereas the number of people who want the new Wolfenstein has increased since the days of Wolfenstein 3D.
Having said that, I do miss light gun games, for example. Like, I really enjoyed the old time crisis on the old...
Well, VR. VR's got you sorted.
Kind of. It's not as good. Generally isn't as good. Like, I've not, apart from perhaps Killing Floor, that was really good VR shooting experience.
Yeah, yeah.
But
I guess what I'm saying is some sort of broader genre sense, like.
Yeah, I almost wouldn't put those in the same box, because, like, your Time Crisis was almost like a pattern recognition, pattern
That's
learning
true.
Game.
And yeah.
And also it had a great sense of humor and a kind of slapstick element to it, and also the fun kind of...
Like House of the Dead 2 is drilled into my brain.
Exactly.
Like 100% drilled into my brain.
Yeah, and that's the thing that's gone away. I mean, obviously it still exists in arcades and stuff, and... I was also lamenting the loss of, like, Rock Band, which I loved and had an amazing time with. That seems to have gone out of style, but you're going to find this stuff in arcades in Japan that is definitely going to be one of the iterations of this.
Yeah, I suppose maybe my view's too broad in that, like, practically things have come and gone, right? Like,
but you're right, they've moved into different places.
But then again, I wondered how much perception bias plays a role there, because, you know, our Rock Band years were... when we were in a cohabiting situation that happened to be with each other at that time. But you know what I mean, right? Like, we're in a situation where Rock Band made loads of sense.
Yeah.
And, like, I've since sort of divested myself of my Rock Band stuff. And, you know, it's like, and that makes sense, because, like, when am I going to do that again compared to other things that have replaced it?
Yeah, yeah.
But I don't want to assume that there aren't college kids somewhere with a Rock Band set up that has been getting use for 10 years and will continue to get use.
Yeah.
Just because you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, you don't know really to what extent.
They're certainly not making new ones, so maybe that's evidence that demand has dried up, but, you know.
Good question.
A good question. Our next question comes from Thomas. And Thomas writes, "Into a room full of Thomases. Dear Cool Cats and Chilly Willies, so Horizon Zero Dawn, The Frozen Wilds has some nice looking snow, but doesn't sound quite right to me. What game have the best sound in snow? Cheers, Thomas."
I would not be surprised if this is not the correct answer to this question, but I distinctly remember loving the sound of snow in Little Big Adventure. Maybe Little Big Adventure 2, actually, because I think that was the sort of true 3D one. And you wake up in the snow at one point, and it has, for me, like, the defining quality of good snow sound is the squeak. You know, anyone can make the trudge, but when it also has a little bit of a squeak to it...
You got to get that trudge and squeak.
Yeah, the trudge and squeak.
It's weird, because, like, I can hear the sound in my head, but I associate it with every video game that's ever had snow, almost like a folio... sound effect that, you know, all games seem to...
Yeah, I remember the same thing, right? Skyrim having good trudge and squeak, but I don't know if that's true.
I remember Grim Fandango having good, lovely snow sound, but there's something really, you know, oddly satisfying about how compressed the sound is in that old adventure game that sort of made that crunchy sound even more satisfying somehow.
Yeah, I think it's... I think... snow is one of those things where if a game gets the entire atmosphere right, your brain can fill in certain gaps. Like, for example, the sound, I think. It can sort of feel
that
right.
Subliminal squeak.
Yeah. Yes. The subliminal trudge and squeak.
Yes.
I think of the sort of frozen northy bits of Skyrim as feeling cold, and assumed that they have good trudge and squeak.
Yeah, I did a good job of that, actually, considering the whole thing is cold and wintry.
Right.
I can't remember what the name of it is, but there's one, like, really northerly city that's just feels bitterly cold. Just the whole time you're there, you just kind of, you really want to be indoors.
The mage school with the ruined
Winterhold.
Perhaps. That sounds possible.
But it's got
that's definitely a place in Skyrim.
Like a really shitty town at the base of this massive kind of wizard temple.
Mm.
And the whole, I think they do it with like blizzards. So it's constantly like your vision is obscured all the time. Yeah. It's always difficult just to move around. And that's how they communicate that the inconvenience of the cold to you through just like restricting your vision and making it difficult just to get around.
What is Windhelm? Is that also a city in Skyrim?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, but I think that's a real shithole as well. It's
shitty towns in Skyrim.
Yeah.
That's why I love Skyrim, though. Like, they're happy just to send you to a shithole.
You just pump them nouns into the George R. R. Martin Mad Libs generator and you got yourself a town. Doesn't mean you want to live there.
Yeah. Two of my favorite places in games are in Skyrim, though. There's the place on like the ice where you see the Northern Lights, which is in the northeast of the map. And it's a very specific part where you get this sort of magical Northern Lights kind of type experience, like a proper Arctic Express. Arctic Express is a kind of hellscape.
The
actually,
magic you of the watch. Arctic Express. You just you look up into the sky in Skyrim, and there is the uncanny Tom Hanks beaming back down upon you.
We're
also thankful for
it. It's fun to read the history of that studio, which is now, I think, it's been shut the fuck down because they made the most horrifying
CGI.
You made
the two spooky Tom Hanks.
They did it more than just that.
You had one job and it wasn't this.
You should check out some of their trailers for their other films. They all have the same problem, but worse. the Uncanny Valley was created by that studio. Anyway, also the underground.
Oh shit, Black Reach.
Yeah.
Below the Dwemer.
Everybody remembers exactly one
Skyrim. what an amazing game. Like,
that
so
came out in my first month of PC Gamer.
Right.
And that's still fucking nuts how good that game is.
I'm still subscribed to the Skyrim subreddit because there's something really nice about just seeing a group of people who still play this game and still love it and still talk about it every day and just like showing, I just found this thing that I never found before. Or
It's constantly being re-released and maybe it's, I don't want to play it again. I don't have time for that. That can't be my Christmas game.
Always do.
It can't be Skyrim.
I'd play it on Switch.
It's completely time for another one of them, isn't it?
It really is. Yeah.
It's been.
Didn't they say not that long ago that they haven't even started it? Like.
Yeah.
Hmm.
I mean, appreciate
it. Took me a while.
I think. Yeah, man. I remember when I was like living on a couch in my first month at PC Gamer and going home to my parents' house at the weekends to play Skyrim for like an entire weekend without sleeping and then coming back. Jeez.
Lovely, crunchy, squeaky snow.
Lovely, crunchy, scrudgy.
Scrudgy.
Scrudgy. It's Tweety and Tweety. Fucking hell. Fucking hell. Our final question, thank God, comes from Henry the Eighth. I am.
Wow.
Excellent.
Which is like, will I am, but I don't get it. That's the only difference between this and will I am. Dear careworn Bard Act, in episode 211, you answered a question about games you wished had been released at a different point, a particular point in your life. This sparked conversation about RPGs. It brought to mind a bugbear of mine. I've always loved the mechanics of RPGs, but I'm not a fan of the fantasy genre. Aside from the Fallout series, which I count in my top three of game series, well-produced non-fantasy RPGs seem to be non-existent. Is there a reason for these two facets of gaming to be inextricably linked? Have I somehow missed a raft of excellent RPGs with guns and vehicles, or am I forever cursed to experience this genre through the lens of swords and sandals? Keep podding those pods. Henry VIII, I am. Well, there is definitely a sense to which this is not the case.
Yeah, there have actually been a bunch of sci-fi RPGs. I mean, it depends what he means by well produced.
Yeah,
I mean of their time. I mean, Anachronox was a very good.
Anachronox is great.
I mean, Mass Effect is an RPG, right?
Mass Effect, yeah. A little bit of an RPG. Very good science fiction.
You mentioned KOTOR earlier.
Yeah, KOTOR. Another great example.
I would suggest the Shadowrun.
Yeah, those games. Awesome. Yeah.
I mean, that is a little bit fantasy because it's like cyberpunk orcs.
Yeah.
It depends whether your problem is orcs or medieval Europe. Basically.
Yeah.
Depends what
I think Shadowrun will get around that question. I think that's a good counterexample.
Yeah. Definitely. And particularly, it's a traditional CRPG in a lot of ways. It's a cyberpunk RPG, but it's a traditional CRPG. So that's the experience you're looking for then.
Actually, I really enjoy seeing fantasy archetypes recontextualized in a science fiction environment. It's one of the reasons I love Destiny.
Yes.
Because it's very good at taking orcs, goblins, dragons, and that sort of thing. And
you know, Warhammer 40,000, right?
Well, yeah, definitely. Like, yeah.
It's got elves, it's got orcs,
With all the, you know, what does that look like transposed into a different technological environment? And I think loads of game mods do a great job of doing that. I mean, I'm looking forward to Cyberpunk from CD Projekt Red.
Yeah, I really am as well.
That could be a great modern example.
If you liked Fallout, you might like Wasteland.
Mm.
Wasteland 2 is a modern...
Again, Fallout. I mean, it's kind of like oldie sci-fi, but it's still sci-fi. It's still guns. It's still,
yeah.
You know, the Fallout games are a good example.
A bit more left field, but Neo Scavenger, I think, is... Graham is always raving about how good that game is, and that's a like post-apocalyptic kind of RPG thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm.
Yeah, God, loads of examples.
I think there's a bigger question bit here about why fantasy suits the RPG.
Yeah, I think some of it is down to just like almost your tools and what you're doing. So I think attaching RPG systems to guns has always been a tricky thing.
Yeah.
Whereas swords and maces.
You can't really explain why I do more damage as a high-level character with guns.
For sure, yeah, for sure.
Like, more accuracy, for sure, but like, when I hit them, why would my bullet do more damage?
Exactly, like, you should, the tool is doing the work for you.
Whereas, like, in fantasy games, strength, it makes sense that strength is a factor. Whereas in modern situations, strength is not really a factor in your combat effectiveness.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's a chicken and egg thing here, a chag, if you will, about whether or not our game design happens to suit fantasy settings or fantasy settings created kinds of game design. Like,
you know,
a lot of these mechanics are derived from Dungeons & Dragons, and Dungeons & Dragons was, I believe, in its first iteration, an attempt to create the drama of a fantasy novel within a game system.
Yes.
So the two things are to
fantasy intricately game first,
related
right.
to each other. Yeah. Like, you know, it wasn't like, I've created this game system, what kind of fiction works with it? It was, we want to have a big old hobbit in our basement right now. How do we do this? And that was the problem it solved. So
it's kind of telling that the, you know, the most popular sci-fi, world is Star Wars, which frankly shares a lot with fantasy stuff.
Absolutely.
Like, there's swords and magic.
Star Wars is such a weird set. I think one of the reasons for its enduring popularity is that it's so hard to categorize as a setting. It's sort of, it you really know it when you see it, but it's really hard to pin down Star Wars to either fantasy or sci-fi fully, because it really doesn't wholly fit one of them. It's really easy to say that.
Technically, it's a long time ago. So it can't be sci-fi.
Exactly. But it's far, far away. in a galaxy. So, you know.
Which is sci-fi.
Yeah. and that's one thing, you know, like we were saying earlier, maybe from a more mercantile point of view, but it supports lots of different kinds of fantasy all at the same time.
Yeah.
Because it can be a military fantasy. It can be a
If you like spaceships
fantasy.
Or swords, you're going to like this, which is a big audience.
Or even just like gangster movies. Like,
yes.
It's like many genre fictions within one, like metafiction. That's kind of what Star Wars does so well.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And which is one, KOTOR works, right?
Yeah.
Like, KOTOR works is because I've always thought applying damage on Mr. Lightsabers was a tricky thing. Trickier than swords.
Yeah, can't get away from that.
But nonetheless.
KOTOR has like...
vibro blades.
Yeah, that's what's going on.
And Cortosis Weave, which is the material that resists lightsabers. That's how they explain it in KOTOR.
Is that an Yggdrasil, though? Yggdrasil, I might have pronounced that horribly. Like, the little animals, they're in the extended fiction that you...
It's Alamiri.
Oh, right, okay, there we go. What is an Yggdrasil? That's
Yggdrasil is the...
Oh, that's
tree.
A Norse... It's the Norse world tree.
You think,
why did I confuse those?
Well, because they're both weird fantasy words that begin with why.
White, yeah.
And then Teldrassil is in World of Warcraft, right? That's the giant tree in...
Yeah, that's the Yggdrasil of World of Warcraft.
Salamari,
which is the force-eating salamanders.
Yes. You sort of that, like,
you have one, and the Jedi can't do shit to you.
Yeah.
Look at my salamander.
And then you're basically Blofeld, which is what I was left about that. Exactly. Like, rotate your chair, you've got Salamari.
They have discreetly axed them from the new canon.
Right.
For really good reason.
Okay.
Yeah. Because all the old Star Wars Expanded Universe ever had to do was have a villain slowly rotate in a chair and be like, but I'm holding a salamander.
I'm holding the world
fuck
tree.
You gonna do, Luke Skywalker. But there's a lovely moment when, Thrawn, who's like one of the that shows up in season 3 of Star Wars Rebels, and there's a like a dual carving of two Salamiri kind of entwined on his mantelpiece, and they're not in the fiction anymore, but they did a little tribute.
Oh, I see. Nice. Yeah,
that show's really good, even though it's a show for kids. It's both.
Yeah.
What were we talking about?
Yggdrasil.
Yggdrasil. The world tree.
A man suddenly rotates with the world tree in his arms. Suddenly, you can't do shit.
You can't do shit because it's amazing.
It's everything but nothing at the same time.
You just disappear into the branches of this world tree.
Sci-fi RPGs was the
That's right, yeah. I think we answered that
question. Yeah, I think we did. Yeah, I think you will find them. Like, I do think... Also, I mean, I think maybe there is another, a different genre of thing here, which is that, fantasy tends towards the kind of epic storytelling. Cause in the context that this question is referring to, which was the games we wish were released earlier in our lives, that took the direction we wish there were more of these massive RPG series when we were younger and had more time to really sink into them. And that's because fantasy tends to lend itself to these kinds of like huge stories. Not that sci-fi doesn't, and sci-fi of course does, but I think, maybe what I'm saying is wrong. Basically, what I'm thinking is that sci-fi tends to have a sort of more of kind of like a world-building aspect, or like a kind of smaller, more discrete parcels of kind of internally coherent, just run beer can up down the microphone cable type, like, you can imagine living there. Type setting, whereas fantasy is more about having kind of like an epic fable woven around your particular character, and that fits that kind of medieval fantasy better. That, however, might be complete bollocks. I was trying to think about the difference between like Star Trek and Star Wars, right? Like Star Wars is big fable fantasy, and Star Trek is discrete TV, bite-sized episodes, world you live in fantasy.
Yeah, I was trying to compare like Raymond E. Feist's kind of magician books and space operas and like Ian M. Banks stuff.
Yeah, I was thinking about Ian M. Banks as well. Yeah. So I was thinking about that because like, yeah, culture stories are big.
Right, but people within those are rarely heroes.
Yeah. Yes, they are. Like it would be hard, ironically, to make the game of Player of Games because it's about the kind of sci-fi is a lot about the, this is what I'm trying to say. Sci-fi is a lot about the resolution of a set of systems in a big universe that kind of makes sense within the logic set up by the fiction. There's very rarely a kind of moralistic or sort of for the sake of it, deus ex machina to rescue the hero in like hard sci-fi, for example, right?
Yeah. I think there's an obsession with the hero's journey in fantasy that doesn't necessarily translate into a lot of equally epic and well thought out science fiction.
Yeah. And I guess the hero's journey is the definition of a video game plot, right?
But also Star Wars, like,
that's the Star Wars' biggest fantasy element is the fact that it has the hero's journey at its core, even though actually I think that's often been overstated. Like, I think people have taken the fact that George Lucas cites Joseph Campbell as evidence that that is the only thing guiding Star Wars, when actually that's obviously not the case because he was equally influenced by World War II movies. And loads of other things. And you look at like Luke Skywalker's journey in that film is not a traditional hero's journey because he is like resolutely decentered from the second movie onwards, where like Empire Strikes Back, Luke sits in a swamp with a Muppet while the other characters that you care about just do stuff for a film, and he doesn't, you know what I mean? Like, it's about him, but it's not really about him, which is already destabilizing that traditional kind of like, we are going to follow this character as they go on a trip.
Yeah, there's some elements to it. Like, it's like he's got his call to action, he's resisting it and grappling with it. That's kind of what the second movie's about him, isn't it? But it's unconventional, definitely, especially when he gets into the third act. And there's some disillusionment with Luke, which is always what I find really interesting about
it. Man, this is a different podcast again. But like, I would say that sci-fi tends to challenge a lot of the assumptions that fantasy builds its big crescendos on top of, which is neither good nor bad. It's just a thing, and maybe makes fantasy a better fit for the kinds of big video game stories that we're thinking about when we say things like Baldur's Gate series, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
In a funny way, you're saying like, it would be hard to make a game of player games, and I agree. But maybe one of the closest things we have is Pyre, where it is about playing a game. There is a game within the game that is the sort of context for its conflicts, and the different factions within it have their own personalities and backstories and stuff. And increasingly that is reflected in how they play that game. Like in Pyre, it's maybe a bit more literal in that, like, the actual rules change, like the slime guys or the snake guys, I can't remember what their theme is, but they, like, leave trails, and so their auras work differently to other things, which is just changing the rules of the game. Whereas in Player of Games, if I recall...
Play of the Game by A&M Banks.
Blizzard and A&M Banks.
360 no scope. Yeah, exactly. And now you're Emperor.
If only he'd thought to choose Reaper and just do his ultimate in the middle of the board.
Man, that fluffed Mercy Rare has really fucked his civilization.
Yeah.
I take it back. Overwatch is the best.
Please, somebody make sense of that. And make the alternate, like, slip cover for Ian M. Banks' Player of Games, where it's the man, Ian M. Banks, getting Player of the Game. That is all of the questions we have time for this week. If you'd like to send us a question for a future episode of the Creighton Crowbar, you can do so at questions@creightoncrowbar.com. You can also tweet us at Creighton Crowbar. And hang out with our lovely Discord community on Discord, obviously, which you will find the details for on our website at creightoncrowbar.com. That's how that works. This episode, as with all the main episodes of the Creighton Crowbar, is supported by our Patreon, which you can find out more details about at patreon.com/creightoncrowbar. Every penny you give us for this goes towards either supporting the main PC gaming podcast, but also our spin-offs like Miniatures Monthly, which will be returning pretty soon at this point, or the new ITV Poirot podcast we do, because of course we do, which is a lot of fun. That's Little Grey Cells. That's happening every week. There's also the Bloodborne series, which we apologize. It's had a bit of an extended hiatus due to just crazy work and things, but it'll be back hopefully pretty soon. What else do we do? There's more. We've got some cool stuff coming before Christmas as well. If you would like to check out the episodes on YouTube, you can do so at youtube.com/CreightonCrowbar. And as ever, if you aren't interested in the Patreon, but you would like to help us out or support the podcast, one of the things you can do is leave a review or a rating on iTunes, because it does help punt us up them charts. And everyone likes that. Everyone loves being punted up a chart. Take it from me. Otherwise, you can follow us as individuals if you like. I'm on Twitter at C Thurston. That's CTHURSTEN. Tom?
I am I, Tom Senior. I'm at PCDUDO, which is LEDO.
I, Tom Francis, am at Pentadact, PENTADACT.
Two times in this episode, I've said Tom and looked directly between you two, therefore not making a decision. And both times, Tom Senior has taken the initiative.
Oh, no. What does it mean?
Oh, it just means you've got a higher initiative score than Tom Francis.
Yes. Thanks for listening,
everybody. Bye.